a service of KIBMRadio.com, the Internet's home for an all-old-time radio.
Cigarette in America to give you premium quality in both regular and king size brings you Dragnet. Ladies and gentlemen, the story you're about to hear is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent. You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned a robbery detail. You've just rounded up a vicious gang of thieves. The heavy man is still at large. Your job? Get him. Hello, this is George Fenneman. I want to talk to you about the cigarette that's really on the move. The one everyone's talking about and trying. Chesterfield. First cigarette in America to give you premium quality in both regular and king size. Chesterfield King Size is exactly the same quality and exactly the same blend of tobacco as Chesterfield Regular Size. There is absolutely no difference, except that King Size Chesterfield is larger, contains considerably more of the same tobaccos. So much more, it gives you a 21% longer smoke, yet costs very little more. And Chesterfield King Size contains better tobaccos and is of higher quality than any other King Size cigarette. So, sound off for Chesterfield. Either way you like them, regular or king size, Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
Dragnet, the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case transcribed from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Tuesday, March 6th. It was windy in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of robbery detail. My partner's Frank Smith. The boss is Captain Didion. My name's Friday. It was 2:46 p.m. when I got to room 27A. Robbery. Frank?
Yeah, Joe?
How about those subpoenas?
Took them down to the warrant office. They're going to serve them.
Oh, fine. All the follow-ups made, packages in order. That about wraps it up, doesn't it?
Yeah, all but Bentley.
Yeah, nothing from Mac yet.
No, he said he'd call as soon as he heard anything.
Yeah, he'll be happy when we get him, won't you? He's probably the worst of the lot.
Yeah. Don't worry what Mac said. He's in real trouble now. Broke. None of his friends will have anything to do with him. We'll turn him.
I don't think I'll ever understand a guy like Bentley. What makes a man want to beat somebody just for the sake of beating him?
Figure that, we'll have it made.
32 robberies, and just about every one, Bentley's got to work over at least one of the victims. It's pretty vicious.
Now we get him this time, he's through. Probably knows it, too. Even Mac blows the whistle, probably going to be rough to take, isn't he?
Yeah.
Joe, I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm happy it's over. And let's face it, we were lucky on this one. The guys were gun happy. Taking any longer to get him, they'd have killed somebody, sure.
Maybe so.
Well, in my next day off, I'm going to do nothing but sit, not make a move. My feet are killing me.
Yeah, we had a lot of legwork on this one.
Not just this one, Joe, all of them. I was reading in the magazine the other day about a new kind of arch support. I got to get me a pair of them.
Yeah?
According to the ad, these are going to be just a ticket. Some new kind of rubber, soft, when they mold it to your feet. Place back in Wisconsin.
Well, how do they do it? They got a place here in L.A.?
No, just a home office. Just a small place, I guess. According to the ad, the whole process is pretty new.
Yeah, well, how do you get this? What is it, a mold?
Yeah, you stand on a piece of paper, hold a bucket of water in each hand. You know, you put all your weight on your feet.
Yeah.
And you draw the outline of your foot on the paper. They make the arch thing up from there.
If you're holding a bucket of water in each hand, is that right?
Yeah.
Well, how do you use the pencil?
What?
Well, a bucket of water in each hand, how are you going to draw?
Yeah.
I get it. Robbery Friday. Oh, hiya, Faye. Yeah, he's here. Oh, how's the kid? Oh, yeah, sure, I'll put him right on. Frank, it's for you. Your wife seems upset.
Thanks, Joe. Hello, honey. Yeah? I can, but what's up? Well, can't you tell me now? Well, why not? All right, honey, I'll be right there. Don't worry now, huh? Goodbye.
What's the matter? Something wrong?
I don't know. Faye wants me to come right home, says something's going on.
Couldn't she tell you about it on the phone?
No, it says something about the phone being tapped.
We went down to the carpool and started over for Frank's house. For the past 3 months, we'd been working on a case involving a gang that had been operating in the city. During that time, they'd committed 32 armed robberies, and in most instances, they'd beaten their victims for no apparent reason. Their ruthless attitude was the most outstanding single point of their M.O. We'd successfully rounded up all members of the gang with one exception, Leroy Bentley, alias the Bull. Bentley was the known heavy man of the gang. In order to successfully prosecute and apprehend any criminal or criminals, the police officer requires the fullest measure of cooperation and assistance that he can obtain from many people. The private citizen and his own associates as well. From the ranks of the private citizen comes one important aid, the informant. The working detective knows that in many cases his most valuable assistance can often come from his informant. In this particular case, we'd received information that would lead us to Bull Bentley within a matter of days. 3:22 p.m. We arrived at Frank's home.
I'm glad you're home, honey. I'm awfully worried. No, Joe.
Oh, yeah.
What's the trouble now? What's this all about, this phone being tapped?
Well, that's what he said.
Who?
The man who called.
All right, now, honey, can you tell me what this is all about?
I got a phone call just before I called you. It was a man. Said his name was Bull Bentley or Bendy. I didn't get it. He said that you thought you were a smart cop, but if you didn't lay off him, he was going to take care of you where it hurt the most. He threatened the children and me, too. Well, Frank, I don't know what to do.
Go on.
Said the phone was tapped and we were being watched. Said to tell you he wasn't kidding. He didn't have anything to lose. He sounded real mean. I'm frightened. Do you know this man, Frank?
Oh, he is, yeah. We have a warrant for his arrest.
Say, where are the kids?
Well, Stacy's in her room playing. I called the school for Mike. The teacher said she dismissed the class. He should be home by now. Frank, I don't know. I'm worried about him.
All right, lock the doors. Don't open for anybody. Joe and I will go out and see if we can find Mike.
All right, I'm worried sick about him. He should have been home 20 minutes ago.
All right, we'll call the captain, Frank. Ask him to send a couple of men out, huh?
Thanks, Joe.
Don't worry about it, Trey. 2511, please. Yeah, robbery. Hello, Glenn. Captain there. That's Friday. I'd like to talk to him. Skipper, this is Friday. I'm out at Frank's house. Frank Smith, yeah. Bull Bentley called his wife, threatened her and the kids if he didn't lay off. No, said if he didn't lay off. Well, could you send a couple of men out to stand by? Fine. Mike isn't home from school yet. And Frank, Mike's his little boy. Frank and I are going out to look for him. Yeah, I said he'd be watching the house. Who? Yes, well. All right, we'll be in as soon as we find the boy. Right, Skipper. O'Donnell and Stewart from the office will be out, Faye. They'll park the car down the street. Watch for him and let him in, won't you?
All right, Joe. What about it, Frank? You going to lay off this guy?
You want me to?
Please find little Mike.
All right, honey. We'll find him. Well, lock the door and don't open it for anyone but O'Donnell and Stewart when they get here.
All right, dear.
Now, don't worry, huh, honey? We'll find him.
Yeah.
Let's go. Joe, what do you think?
I don't know.
Tell you one thing.
Yeah?
I'm scared.
There are two types of criminals that can be counted on to be dangerous. The youngster who becomes easily panicked at the scene of a crime, and the older criminal who will do anything rather than go back to the penitentiary. Bull Bentley was one of these. We knew that he was more than capable of carrying out his threat. His record was one of armed robbery, vicious beatings, and kidnapping. At this particular time, he was wanted for murder in the state of Colorado. The average criminal will blame anyone but himself for his predicament, usually the police officer, and this was so in Bentley's case. He apparently thought that by getting us off his trail, he could go free. Frank and I searched the area around the house. We found his little boy in a vacant lot two blocks from school playing with a group of youngsters. We put him in the car and returned him to his home. Stewart and O'Donnell were at Frank's house and said they'd stay there until they were relieved. 4:36 p.m. Frank and I checked back into the office.
Smith, Friday, in here.
Right.
Come on in. Find the boy?
Yeah, Skipper, out playing with some of the kids in the neighborhood.
All right. Now, what's this all about?
Well, this bunch we just cleaned up?
Yeah.
Bull Bentley called Frank's wife and told her that if Frank didn't lay off of him, he was going to get to him through his family.
What do you plan to do?
Well, no choice. Get him before he can do anything, I guess.
Frank? Yes, Skipper. You like to be taken off this assignment?
No, it's a personal matter.
It's up to you. Let's see that your house is covered when you're not home. You keeping the boy away from school?
Yeah, Captain, until this thing's over.
You got any ideas where you can pick Bentley up?
Well, he's covered all the places he's known to hang out.
Want any help?
No, not right now. Just find him fast.
Well, you know he's in town. Figure he's going to stay here?
Well, we don't think he's got much choice. We figure he's broke. He's hot. None of his friends will take a chance on putting him up. He's going to need money.
Better cover the bus depots, train depots, alert the airport detail. Get a couple of 100 mugs printed up on him. Yeah. Distribute them to the beat men and radio cars. Contact Captain Hamilton, the intelligence. He might be able to come up with something.
My informant said he could turn Bentley for us in a week.
A week's a long time, Joe.
I know.
You've covered all his hangouts.
All of them. Nobody's seen him in a couple of days. Just seemed to drop out of sight.
Big town, a lot of people. Sometimes you don't realize how big till you start looking for one man.
Yeah.
Want to get in touch with the boys in the press room, give them the story, see if they'll carry Bull's picture. See Jack Ricketts, he'll put the picture on suspects wanted.
We'll get shot out right now.
You got a silent number, haven't you, Frank?
Yeah, it's unlisted.
How'd Bentley get it? It had to come from somewhere.
Joe and I were talking about that. You know pretty much who we'd give the numbers out to. About the only one we can figure to be in a position to give it to Bentley is Harry McLeod.
Your informant?
Yeah.
How long since you've heard from this McLeod? A
couple of days.
Figure maybe he'd cross you, throw in with Bentley?
Well, it's possible. I don't think so, though. He's leveled with us so far.
The number had to come from someplace.
Yeah, well, it sure makes it look like McLeod, doesn't it?
I don't think Mac would give the number away on his own.
Both could get it. We got 32 people to prove it.
Well, we better get on this thing. Come on, Frank.
Right. Check you later, Skipper. Joe, I don't know what I'm going to do.
Well, don't worry. We'll get to him.
No, I mean this two-bit thief calling Faye, threatening her.
Try to take it easy. I know you feel.
Why me, Joe? Bo Bentley's brushed up against 100 different cops in his day. Why me?
Law of averages, I guess. You were handy.
I knew just what to do.
Well, Skipper gave you a choice. If you'd like to go home, nobody'd blame you.
You don't know what it is, Joe. You don't have a family. Something like this can split you in two. Half of you wants to be on the job. The other half is pulling you toward home. Joe, if that cheap punk steps in my front porch, I'm going to lean on him hard.
Now look, Frank, this isn't going to get us any place. Let's get over to the photo lab and get this thing moving, huh?
I could just figure it. 4,000 guys in the department and Bentley has to pick me. Joe, why me?
All right, look, Frank. I could try to spell it for you 100 ways and we still wouldn't come out with any kind of a total. I know what you must be going through, and I'm sorry it's got to be you. I'm sorry it has to be any cop. You're right about me not having a family, but it's squeezing me just as hard as it is you. You and I both knew when we filled out those application blanks what we were taking on. The job, Frank. Maybe I never told you before. Maybe you've been through this, too. I don't know. There isn't a day goes by that I'm on the job here that I don't run into something that breaks my heart. Why did Ed Wilson have to get shot down when he and his partner tried to take that guy out of that rooming house over on 8th Street? Why did Olson and his partner have to end up in the PNF ward last week? Why do you have to run the gamut of every human emotion class of people on earth? Poor to rich, it's all the same. Somebody picks up a gun to knock over the corner gas station, everything hangs in the balance. The minute that thief slips a cartridge into his gun, the gas station attendant, his family, his kids, and every relative he's got slides right onto the short end. Everybody seems to think that wherever crime is concerned, they never get any closer to it than the front page of the morning paper. I know you know this, Frank. For every attempted crime, God only knows how many innocent people are thrown into the balance even before the crime's been committed. That's the way it is, Frank. I'm not trying to tell you anything you don't know, but the minute you passed that exam, you had to make book that something like this could contaminate you just as surely as if you weren't a cop. I guess it's almost a legacy. Nobody's found a vaccine for crime. Nobody's immune. And it's worse with you and me because we know better than to think we can't be touched. We know we can. We invite it every time we roll on a call, every time we pick somebody up, every time a guy gets out of line. The job, Frank. I didn't mean to give you an academy lecture, but if it's any comfort, I'm with you. I know just how you feel, and so do 4,000 other guys right down here.
Yeah. I guess maybe we better get moving, huh?
Yeah, come on.
We took the mugshot of Bentley to the photo lab and asked them to run off 200 copies. We checked with the reporters in the press room, and they promised us full cooperation. Jack Ricketts told us that he'd put the picture on the air the next day. Frank called home and found that there'd been no further calls from Bentley. 6:17 p.m. We started to look for Harry McLeod, our informant. We checked his hotel, but the clerk told us he hadn't been in all afternoon. We started checking his known hangout. In fear of burning McLeod, we were unable to ask for him by name, which made it necessary for us to canvass each individual place. 9:28 p.m. We located McLeod in a small bar that was known to be frequented by thieves. We walked over to the bar and sat down next to him. We ordered a drink. At the first opportunity, without arousing suspicion, we told McLeod we wanted to talk to him and that we'd meet him down the street, two blocks west. We left the bar, got in the car, and drove to the meeting place. 20 minutes later, McLeod arrived, got in the back seat, and we drove away.
Want to get the radio, Joe?
Yeah.
What's the matter with you guys? I told you I'd get in touch with him and I had something for you. You trying to get me burned?
Right, take it easy, Mac. Just a couple of things we want to know.
Well, I'm on your side. You guys know that. I've always leveled with you, haven't I?
Yeah.
Well, then what's this bit? You walk into that joint, you know what goes on in there, and you pull me out. Good chance somebody could have seen you, you know.
Yeah, we know, Mac. Have you seen Bentley?
No, I told you I'd let you know when I turned him.
Now, don't slow us, Mac. This is important. Have you seen him?
If I saw him, I'd have called you. You know that, don't you? I'd have called you guys. I told you once I'd finger him for you. I haven't called. I haven't seen him. It's that simple. What's the big rush about getting Bentley, anyway? You ain't going nowhere.
Now, look, Mac, we got a personal interest in this thing. This isn't just robbery. Bull's been calling Frank's wife, saying he was going to kill her and the kid. You know he'd do it. Now, how about it?
I didn't know it was like that. Bull's mean enough to do it,
well,
too.
That's how it is. Now, I'll ask you once more. Have you seen him?
Yeah.
When?
Day before yesterday, Sunday morning. Saw him down Marty's.
How come you didn't call us?
I couldn't. Honestly, I couldn't. He came in and asked me for some dough. I told him I didn't have any. I tried to stall him till I could get to a phone.
Yeah?
Didn't work. He wouldn't wait. Got mad when I couldn't help him out.
You say anything about a meet?
Just said he'd get in touch with me.
Yeah.
He was real sore when I couldn't let him have any dough, but I told him, I said, look, boy, you know I want to help, but I just haven't got it. That's what I said.
Yeah?
Wasn't kidding either. Things been pretty rough. Say, you guys couldn't see your way clear, could you? Salbuck, you tied me over, huh?
Well, you got me at the wrong time, Mac. I'm tapped.
Well, how about you, Smith?
Well, if you got to have it, I got $10 I've been saving for a pair of shoes.
Yeah, I sure appreciate it. You guys know that.
Yeah, we know. You got any idea how Bull might have gotten Frank's home phone?
No, not the slightest.
You sure you didn't give it to him?
Joe, you've known me for a lot of years. Would I do a thing like that after the way you guys treated me?
Well, that's what we're trying to find out, Mac.
I should get a little insulted at that. You guys figuring out about
it. Oh, now, come off it, Mac. Did you give him the number?
No, I swear to you I didn't.
All right. You got any ideas where Bull might be hiding?
Not in particular. Check usual places?
Yeah, we looked through them all.
And you know as much as I do. He did say he looked me up in a couple of days.
You see where he was going when he left you?
No, just walked out of Marty's. I saw a friend of his yesterday, though.
Yeah?
The guy said he'd seen Bull Sunday night.
Say what he wanted?
Money. Said he'd try to tap him for some dough to get out of town.
His friend help him?
He didn't give him any money. He gave him something else, though.
Yeah.
He gave him a gun.
You are listening to Dragnet. Authentic stories of your police force in action.
Chesterfield is the first and only cigarette in America to give you premium quality in both regular and king size. Just as Chesterfield is the first and only cigarette to tell you what it's made of. Yes, Chesterfield names all its ingredients, so you'll know what gives you the best possible smoke. The world's best tobaccos, pre-tested by laboratory instruments for the most desirable smoking qualities. Pure, costly moistening agents. Costly glycerol and pure sugars, which are natural to tobacco. And cigarette paper of the highest purity. The best that money can buy. That's what's in your Chesterfield. Ingredients that give you the best possible smoke. Much milder, with an extraordinarily good taste. And, as confirmed by a well-known research organization, no unpleasant aftertaste. So, sound off for Chesterfield. Either way you like them, regular or king size, Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
Before we left Mac, he furnished us with the name of the man who'd given the gun to Bull Bentley. We recognized the name Dave Slater as a small-time hoodlum who'd do anything to make a dollar as long as he himself was reasonably safe in doing it. Mac told us of several places where we might find him. The most likely place was a pool room on North Main Street. Slater had numerous arrests, most of them for being drunk and for acting as a lookout for gambling games. He was a type of thief that can be found in every large city, always on the fringe of criminal operations, but never directly involved in the crime itself. We checked several of the places Mac told us about, but we couldn't come up with Slater. We checked the pool room. The manager was evasive and at first appeared reluctant to talk. We informed him that we knew Slater would be back and that we'd wait for him. The manager asked us to come to the back room with him. He told us that Slater had said that he was going down to the all-night hamburger stand on the corner to get something to eat. We found Slater sitting at the counter.
Call it a string of hamburger. All I can see is a bun. I'd be ashamed to sell a thing like this lousy deal 35 cents for nothing.
Slater?
Yeah, well, something you want?
Police officer Slater. We want to talk to you.
What about?
Bull Bentley.
Bentley? Never heard of him.
We got information. You do know him pretty well.
Yeah? You tell your pigeon he's lying. I never heard of the guy. Now, let me finish eating.
We want to talk to you, Slater. You want to make it here? Would you rather go downtown?
Can't you see I'm eating? Now, let me finish. I got nothing to tell you. I don't know any Bull Bentley. Now, lay off, huh?
Come on. You can think better than an empty stomach, Slater. Let's go.
Frank and I took Slater out of the restaurant and put him in the car. Once he was in custody, his attitude changed completely. He said he wanted to help us, but that he didn't know Bull Bentley. 10:44, we got back to the city hall.
I want to stop by the office, Joe. Call home.
All right, I'll be in the interrogation room. You tell us, Skipper.
Yeah.
In here, Slater.
Yeah.
Sit down.
Sure. Look, I told you I want to help you guys out, but I don't know anything. If I did, I'd let you know.
All right, come off it, Slater. Where's Bentley?
Look, I keep telling you, I don't know any Bentley.
Where are you living now?
Sally Hotel, West 5th.
How long you been there?
A couple of days.
You working now?
Yeah, a little. Odd job now and then. You know, nothing steady.
What do you call an odd job, Slater?
Well, you know, sweep out the pool room, rack the balls for him.
Yeah, sure. Now, look, we've known you for 8 years. You never worked a day in that time. Now, how about Bentley? We got a personal interest in him. We want him. We want him bad.
Look, I tell you, I don't know any Bentley.
Anything new?
Yeah, Joe, he called a couple more times tonight. Last time at 10:30, scared Faye half to death.
Yeah.
Said he knew Mike was home. He knew we were looking for him. Said if we don't stop, it'll get to the kids. Said it didn't matter how many cops we had around the house, he'd get to him. Faye's almost hysterical. O'Donnell called the doctor.
Yeah.
How about Slater? He come up with anything?
No. Still says he doesn't know him.
Doesn't know him, huh? Listen, Punk, let's you and me get straightened out. What happens to me is one thing. What happens to my family is another. They don't pay me enough money to jeopardize my family. Now, you get this straight. When punks like you and your trigger-happy friends can threaten my family, then something's got to give, and it's not going to be me.
Yeah, but I told you...
Look, wipe that silly grin off your face, Slater. You feel nice and safe there, don't you? You know, as long as you're in custody, we got to take care of you. Well, maybe you'd like to know that if I have to, I'll take this badge off and walk up one side of you and down the other. Now, I want to know where Bentley is, and I want to know now. We're not stumbling around in the dark. We know you gave him a gun. Let me tell you this, mister. Mark it down. If anything happens to my wife or my kids, you can't run fast enough to get away, because I'll nail you hard.
All right,
thanks. He's getting pretty tough, isn't he?
I'm just telling you how you stand. Now, come on, where's Bentley?
I told you, I don't know Bentley.
All right. Let's get everything out of your pockets. Get it on the table.
Well, there's nothing much. Here, change. Keys. And a nail file. Address book. My handkerchief. Comb, wallet, yeah, cigarettes, and matches. That's all.
I'm going to shake him down, Frank.
Yeah.
I told you that's all. Now, what are you looking for?
Now, push your luck, Slater. It's clean, Joe.
How much money you got in your wallet?
I don't know. Double sawbuck, maybe?
It's a funny thing. You guys never work, but you always got money. All right, take the money out and count it, Slater.
Why? What's that going to prove?
Take it out and count it.
All right. 10, 20... 25, 26, 27, 37, another 5, 42 bucks. I didn't know I had that much.
All right. Put the money in your pocket.
Is that all the money in your wallet?
Yeah, that's it.
Let's see the wallet.
Yeah. Nothing in it. A couple of cards, that's all.
Yeah. Let's see here. A couple of pawn tickets. Picture. Who's the girl?
Babe, I met in Dago. You don't know her. She's not in the rackets. Married now. I haven't seen her in a year.
Then why are you carrying her picture?
I always kind of liked her. Shit class. Real nice broad.
You said you didn't know Bo Bentley?
That's what I said.
How about Leroy Bentley?
Nah.
You know anybody at all named Bentley?
Look, I told you I don't know any Bentley. How many times do I have to tell you?
You know anybody by the name of Bull?
I don't know anybody named Bull. I don't know anybody named Bentley.
Yeah. Take a look, Joe.
Hmm. Now, maybe you can explain this then.
Yeah, what's that?
Bar tab in your wallet. Name Bull written on it. How about it, Slater? Who's Bull?
I don't remember that. Probably something I picked up a long time ago. I don't remember.
Tab dated March 4th. Day before yesterday. Your memory must be getting pretty bad, huh?
I got nothing to say.
Well, Frank, you want to check the business office and see who this number is listed to?
Yeah, Joe, right away.
All right, fine. I'm going to tell you something, boy. This is a rotten deal. The law protects people like you. You're lying. We know it, and you know it, too. You know Bentley. You know where he is. What's more, we know you gave him a gun Sunday night, the same date on that tab. I'll tell you what we're going to do, Slater. You're a real wise guy. You talk fast. We're going to get Bo. Maybe not tonight, maybe not tomorrow, but we'll get him. And when we do, we're going to tell him that you blew the whistle on him. We're going to put him in the same cell with you. I'd like to hear you talk your way out of that.
You wouldn't do that.
Don't make book on it.
Look, he's a mean guy. He'll kill me.
Thought you didn't know him.
All right, so I know. But you wouldn't do that. Would you put me in with him?
Where is he, Slater?
You going to tell him I turned him in?
We're making no deals. Where is he?
I don't know where he is now.
You know where he'll be.
Yeah, I was supposed to meet him there tonight at the bar down on West 7th. He's got a friend who works there, feeds him.
He'll be there tonight, huh?
Yeah, I said if I'd meet him, he'd pay me for the gun, 75 bucks.
What kind of gun is it?
A 38. A good one, too. Worth more than 75 bucks, but I needed the money.
Where'd you get the gun?
Well, you'll find out anyway. I might as well tell you. Prowled the car, found under the seat. I found out later it belonged to a guy in the vice squad. Probably real sore about it.
Could be Joe Barn, West 7th, place called the Hamilton Inn.
Yeah, that's it. He'll be there.
All right, Slater, let's go.
Where are you taking me?
You're going to jail.
No, you can't win. Should have known you. Hey, do me a favor, huh?
What's that?
Talk to the jailer, make him give me a cell by myself.
We handcuffed Slater to a chair in the robbery office until we got back to booking.
12:32 a.m., Frank and I left the city hall for the Hamilton Inn on West 7th Street. Slater had told us that he was to meet Bull Bentley between 1 and 1:30. When we got there, there were a half a dozen people in the place. We checked the bar and the men's restroom, but Bentley wasn't around. We went back to the car, drove down the street to a closed service station, and parked where we could keep both doors of the restaurant under surveillance. 12:50, 1 a.m., 1:15. We waited. 1:35.
Joe, that him?
I don't know. It might be. Let's take a look. All right. You want to take the side door? I'll try the front.
Right.
All right.
See him, Joe.
Wait a minute. Is that him? Going in the phone booth back there?
Yeah.
All right, come on. I'll get him.
Bentley.
Yeah.
Watch it, Joe!
Shake him down.
Who told you? Who blew the whistle? That bum McCloud. It was him. He was the only one who knew.
He gave you my telephone number?
Yeah, he did. And he runs to you and cops out. Should have known better. I give him $20 for it.
Well, that figures.
What do you mean?
We gave him 10 not to.
The story you have just heard was true. The names were changed to protect the innocent.
On June 12th, the hearing was held in the district attorney's office. In a moment, the results of that hearing.
Now, here is our star, Jack Webb.
Thank you, George Fenneman. Friends, I'd like to talk to you about something that's important to every one of you. Now, for the first time, you can get a premium quality cigarette in either regular or king size. Of course, that's Chesterfield. Both regular and king size Chesterfields are made of the proven ingredients that give you the best possible smoke. Both are much milder, with an extraordinarily good taste and no unpleasant aftertaste. Yes, there's no difference between the two, except king-size Chesterfield is larger, contains so much more of the same tobaccos, it gives you a 21% longer smoke, yet it costs very little more. So remember, either way you like them, regular or king-size, Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
Roy W. Bentley was released to the Colorado authorities for prosecution on a charge of murder. A hold was placed on him for the state of California in the event he is paroled. He was convicted and is now serving a life sentence in the Colorado State Penitentiary without possibility of parole. Although David R. Slater was guilty of aiding and abetting a felony, a complaint could not be issued due to the fact it could not be proved that Slater knew Bentley was an ex-convict when he gave him the gun. He was filed on for petty theft in Division 7. He pled guilty and was sentenced to 90 days in the county jail. You have just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice comes from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department. Technical advisors, Captain Jack Donahoe, Sergeant Marty Wynn, Sergeant Vance Frazier. Heard tonight were Herb Ellis, June Whitley, Jack Crucian. Script by John Robinson. Music by Walter Schumann. Hal Gibney speaking.
These great programs sound off for Chesterfield. Radio, Dragnet, the Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis Show, and every weekday Arthur Godfrey time. On television, Dragnet, Gangbusters, Arthur Godfrey and his friends, and the Perry Como Show.
Tomorrow, you'll want to sound off for Chesterfield, because either way you like them, regular or king size, Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
Chesterfield has brought you Dragnet, transcribed from Los Angeles.
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Regan. I work for Anthony J. Lyon, International Detective Bureau. They call me the Lion's Eye.
Jeff Regan, Investigator, starring Frank Graham as Regan with Frank Nelson as Anthony J. Lyon. So stand by for mystery, suspense, and adventure in tonight's story of The Two Little Sisters.
When a 6 foot, 200-pound guy turns up with a knife in his back, maybe a short 100 pounds of cool green-eyed blonde did it. And maybe she didn't. Well, this time there were two blondes, sisters. They looked alike, but they were about as much alike as a sheepdog and a cobra. Goes to show you can't tell by the package. Their names were Zemanski, Mary and Dolly Zemanski. They worked for the Everybody's Happy Pastime Carnival shows. It was old E. Happy Pastime himself who was sitting in the Lion's office when I got there about noon.
Jeffrey, my boy, glad you've come in. I'd like you to meet our new client, proprietor of the Everybody's Happy Pastime Carnival shows. No doubt you've heard of them, Jeffrey.
Sure. How are you?
Laryngitis? Yeah, our friend here is troubled with laryngitis, Jeffrey. Purely psychological. A result of worry. Profound worry. Isn't that right, sir? Yes. Yes. Well, Jeffrey...
What do we do?
Now, Jeffrey, I'm glad you asked that question. To tell the truth, I envy you. Fine opportunity for you to get out of the city while I sit here sweltering in this heat. You, Jeffrey...
Get to the point.
Yes. Well, Jeffrey, the fact is our friend here leaves on the 2 o'clock plane for Phoenix, Arizona. Advance arrangements for the carnival.
Sure.
Well, meantime, the star performer of Everybody's Happy Pastime Carnival shows, a girl named... Now where's that piece of paper? I jotted it down. Here we are. Dolly Zemanski, the Queen of the Blades.
Ice skater?
Knife thrower.
Oh, I get it.
She's a knife thrower with the show, Jeffrey. Best in a line, they say.
Well, what's the trouble?
That's just it. Someone's been threatening her. A man named Rand. Rand. It's upsetting her, Jeffrey. Beginning to show in her work. That's what worries our client here.
What's Rand got on her?
Well, I don't know, Jeffrey. Our client doesn't know. Isn't that right, sir? Yes. No, but we'll retain to find out.
And get rid of him.
Exactly. Get rid of him. Get rid of him, Jeffrey.
Like the Lion said, it was a chance to get out of the city. I drove Father Time back out to his carnival. He had to pick up his stuff and then make the 2 o'clock plane at International Airport. The carnival was set up on a couple of vacant lots out on Sepulveda. Big sign, Everybody's Happy Pastime Carnival Shows. Tents, trailers, Ferris wheel, sawdust, the usual stuff. The old guy pointed out Dolly Zemanski's trailer, and I was on my own. I didn't get far. Guy in a 1922 tux, 3 days whiskers, and a turban like a second-hand bird's nest stopped me.
Oh, there. How do you do, sir?
The only legitimate thing about the Swami was his breath. That was 90 proof.
You are Regan.
What's up to you?
I am Swami Al-Kaji. Step this way, please, into my tent. I will consult the crystal. The crystal ball tells me many things.
Yeah? Like what?
Sit right here, Mr. Regan.
Thanks.
The crystal ball tells me, Mr. Regan, that you've been hired to help Dolly Zemanski. Tells me you have been hired by... by the owner of our little carnival.
How much of that did he tell you?
Yes, Mr. Regan, it was he who told me. I saw you arrive together.
What do you know about Rand?
Fred Rand, let me see. Yes, let me see. The crystal ball is cloudy. The sand of time runs through the glass, Mr. Regan.
Cut it out.
What do you mean?
You're a swami like Truman's a Republican.
Yes, true. Well, have a drink, Mr. Regan. I see much more in this than in the crystal ball. Yes, say when.
When?
Here you are.
Thanks.
I'm a four-finger man myself, Mr. Regan. Been my ruin.
You said you had information.
Yes, there are two sisters.
Zemansky?
Yes, Dolly and Mary.
Who's Mary?
The younger sister.
She new to the show?
A few months with us.
Her sister get her the job?
Yes, Dolly Zemansky's our star performer. Naturally, she has influence.
Okay. What about Rand?
I will consult the crystal ball.
Look, I don't get paid by the hour. What's Rand got on Dolly Zemansky?
I don't know.
No?
I see letters forming in the crystal.
Okay, okay. Play it your way.
F-Z. I can't see any more now. Perhaps if you'd care
see
to... But Mr. Regan. Mr. Regan!
Maybe the Swami had something to sell. But if I couldn't get it for free, I could go back and buy it later. It was only a little ways to Dolly Zemansky's trailer. Big, expensive job. Everything was wide open because of the heat, so I walked in. Nobody home. Lady's clothes lying around. Theatrical makeup. Grease paint stick. Picture of some round-faced guy with a crew cut signed, "Yours adoringly." No name. Knives and daggers around. And a frosty blonde with green eyes in the doorway watching me.
What are you doing in here?
Homework.
It's clever.
Who are you?
That's what I ought to ask you.
Oh, yes. You're Dolly Zemansky.
No, I'm her sister.
Mary Zemansky.
Yes.
I'm Jeff Regan, International Detective Bureau.
You're a detective?
That's it. You joined the carnival about 4 months ago.
5 months.
5 months. Been in show business before?
No, I was a boy back home, but I...
That him?
What?
Photo on the dressing table.
No. Sister Pine.
Pine?
He's in love with my sister.
Pine. Pine, don't I?
Harold Pine. J.J. Pine's son.
Yeah?
You know, Pine warehouses. They're all over Los Angeles.
So your sister's going to marry them?
Why, I think so.
But maybe she isn't.
Mr. Regan,
supposing you give me what you know, hmm? About 4 days ago, a guy turned up, Rand.
Yes.
Your sister scary?
No, Mr. Regan, that's just it. She's strong-minded. She left home when she was 15.
Go on.
Well, life can't have been easy for her, you know, show business.
Just tell it.
Well, she's independent, Mr. Regan. I've tried to tell her...
What about Rand?
Mr. Regan, I can't tell you.
Lady, I've got a job to do. What about Rand?
I don't know.
Your sister scared of him?
I...
She is or she isn't?
It's something else. She told me she didn't know him. She said he was trying to get fresh, but twice I shouldn't tell you this.
My fee says I help your sister.
All right. There's a little street 2 blocks up Sepulveda. Twice I walked by there, this morning and 2 days ago. There was a green sedan parked there both times, and Fred Rand and my sister were in it. They were... Well, they seemed to be arguing. Mr. Regan, that's all I know.
Okay. How do I find your sister?
She performs in the main tent, but she must be just about through. She might be over there.
Okay. See you. I started for the main tent and got about halfway up the midway when he passed me, going down the midway, and into the big shiny trailer. Broad-shouldered, 6-foot guy with red hair. And when he went into the Zemansky sister's trailer, I knew he was Rand. I started for the trailer. I thought I heard voices quarreling. And then I knew something was wrong. That was Mary Zemansky screaming. I hadn't had my eye off the door of that trailer 60 seconds since I left. Nobody went in but Rand. Nobody came out. But I busted fast. I made the last 100 yards like Mel Patton on Dexedrine. But what I saw when I got inside that trailer stopped me cold. It was Mary Zemansky and Rand. But it wasn't like I figured. Mary was hanging onto the wall and staring down at the floor, sobbing. And on the floor was Rand, with a knife in his back. All right, give it to me. Give it to me fast.
No.
What happened? Come on.
No, I can't tell you. I can't.
But you've got 10 seconds before the whole carnival will be in here. What happened? Tell me what happened.
I won't talk.
All right, both of you, stand back at the end of the trailer.
Who are you?
Sergeant Post, police. Hands above your heads. All right. Clear away now. Clear back, folks.
You were Dolly Zemanski?
No, I'm your sister, Mary Zemanski.
Your turn, mister.
Maybe we can take our hands down.
You armed?
Yeah.
Where do I get it? Hip?
Shoulder.
Okay. Set him down.
Thanks.
Got a permit to carry this?
Sure.
Show it.
Regan, private detective, International Detective Bureau. Here's the file copy.
Look good, Regan. You kill this guy? Okay, Regan. Well, maybe you'll tell me who the guy was.
His name was Fred Rand.
That check, Regan?
What I heard.
Maybe you knew Rand, Regan.
Nope.
How'd you get in here so quick?
Heard screams.
Sure. Oh,
what's the use of all this? You both know what happened.
No, what did?
Mr. Rand came in and Well, he'd been bothering Dolly. Maybe he thought I was Dolly. We look a little bit alike. And he came in and...
And? Go on.
We struggled. And I killed him.
It hung together like the Jap Navy. She was sore at Rand because he'd been bothering her sister, so when the big 6-foot guy came into the trailer, she grabbed him and stabbed him in the back. Sure, it could have happened like that. But from the look that came on Sergeant Post's face, I could see he'd try to make it stick. He looked like a hungry kid at a bakery window. He was seeing Lieutenant Stripes. Well, half an hour later, Mary went off for the ride downtown in the paddy wagon. I figured it was a funny thing Dolly Zemanski hadn't showed up. I decided to look for her. She wasn't around. She'd finished her act a little bit before the ruckus started and looked like nobody'd seen her since. Then I saw a tent with some stars and crescent moons painted on the front, and that reminded me of something. A phony swami with information for sale. He was inside. All right, Swami, get busy on that crystal ball and dish up some answers.
Yes.
Like FZ.
Ah, yes, yes, the letters FZ. The crystal is clearly...
Oh, clear it. It's a murder rap now. FZ what?
Ah.
Rand.
Yes, Mr. D.
Fred Rand.
Mrs. Fred Zemanski Rand.
Dolly Zemanski was his wife. Now you've said something. That gave me something to work on, but... Halfway to my car, I remembered something else. Something Mary Zemanski had said. A green sedan parked twice in the same place. Maybe it was parked there a third time. It figured the owner wouldn't be driving it away. He was taking a free ride as a guest of the county, to the morgue. It was there, green sedan, on the little street 2 blocks up Sepulveda. The door was unlocked. The registration on the steering post read, Fred Rand. That figured. The address was on a street called Delancey in San Francisco. But maybe I wouldn't have to go that far. There was a card down on the floorboards. One of those commercial hotel cards. Globe Hotel, Main Street. I stuck it in my pocket. That was when a guy said...
I'm gonna kill you, Fred Rand.
I hit the car door with my shoulder. That knocked him back, but he came in again and tried for me. I blocked it.
Why, you freak...
That was when I got a good look at him. He was the guy in the picture in the Zemanski sister's trailer. Yours adoringly, Harold Pine. I'd like to have stuck around and had a little talk with Harold Pine. Maybe knew some answers. The one answer he didn't know was who killed Fred Rand. When he made that college try on me and called me Rand, it didn't take the FBI to figure he didn't even know Rand was dead. But it looked like Pine was going to be asleep a while, so I went downtown. The Globe Hotel. Last stop on the line for the canned heat crowd. Brass platoons. Row of cracked leather chairs along the front. 2 or 3 old guys dying in them. Nobody at the desk, so I picked up number 306 from the register and went up. Door wasn't locked. Inside, you could see why. Nothing in the joint but a brass bed. Cardboard suitcase on a chair with a couple of neckties in it. Fred Rand had been traveling wide. But there was something else in the suitcase stuck in the lining. Item torn out of the weekly variety, the show business sheet. It said a couple of knife throwers named Duncan and Dolly had checked out of Las Vegas for work at a spot called the Blue Dolphin Casino, Los Angeles. The dateline was half torn off, but you could make out the 46 at the end. There was a phone on the wall, and I tried the Lou Dolphin Casino. There was nobody home. Too early for a night spot. So I decided to let the lion work on that one.
Detective Bureau, Anthony J. Lyon, President speaking.
Lyon, I've got something for you.
Jeffrey, I'm glad you called. I've just talked to the proprietor of the Everybody's Happy Pastime Carnival shows from Phoenix.
So we're off the job.
Well now, Jeffrey, what can we expect? We were retained to get rid of that fellow Rand, to relieve Miss Dolly Zemansky of any undue nervous stress that might endanger the box office value of her performance.
Go on.
Now, Jeffrey, it just seems that, this sister did the job for us.
Sure she did.
Jeffrey, I don't think I understand you.
You can understand this. This job we stick on.
Jeffrey, be reasonable. The matter's in the hands of the police.
They got the wrong goose.
What's that?
I don't think she stabbed a 6-foot guy in the back. I think somebody pitched the strike out into the window.
Dolly Zemansky?
Maybe. I think that's what her sister thinks. I think that's why she confessed.
Oh, I see what you're driving at now. We're defending the innocent again. We're not in business for money, are we, Regan? Why should we be with the world full of poor unfortunates waiting to be held?
Cut it out.
Regan, from now on, if you want to work for charity, you work alone. You're fired.
That's the only good news I've had all day. I checked out of Rand's hotel the same way I went in. When I was crossing the street, I saw somebody coming up the other sidewalk. My high school geometry told me that if I walked fast enough, I could get opposite where my car was parked the same time she did. Okay, come on.
Let go of me!
Come on, sister. Get in the car.
You can't do this to me.
You're Dolly Zemansky, and I'm doing it. Get in there. And stay still. I don't like you, Dolly.
How do you know my name?
You look like your sister.
Mary?
Mary.
Who are you?
Never mind.
Well, where are you taking me?
All right, up Hill Street. There's a place to park above Central. There's a nice view of the city jail.
Jail?
That's right, jail. All right, there. Like I said, that's a good view.
What's the pitch, Regan?
How'd you get back?
The Regan? It's on the steering post.
You got good eyes.
Thanks, honey.
I didn't say that way.
So you don't love me. What's the pitch?
See that building down there? It's the city jail. Do you know who's in it?
No!
It's your sister.
Mary?
Mary.
Why?
She says she killed a guy named Fred Rand.
Fred Rand?
Never heard of Fred Rand, then. Then why were you going to the Globe Hotel? You never heard of that either. Talk, will you? Okay, I will. You get the Pine Warehouses on the hook. It looks good, but there's just one thing wrong. Fred Rand. You're married to him. The guy turns up. Maybe he heard about Harold Pine. He blackmails you.
Okay, he blackmails me, so what?
So you want to get rid of him. You come back from your act this afternoon with the knives in your hands. You get near the trailer. The window's open. You see Rand inside arguing with his sister. That must have been an easy pitch for the star of the show. Your sister's locked up down there on a murder rap to cover you, and you've got nothing to say. Okay. I got nothing on you. Not now. But you'll talk. Later. Now get out. I got business. That gave me nothing, so I went down to the jail to try to see Mary Zemansky again. It took me an hour to find out I wasn't going to get to her. But I did find out one thing. That cop had done his job well. Mary had signed a written confession to the murder of Rand. I got in my car and bucked traffic out to Ventura Boulevard. I hit a gas station and checked the address of the Blue Dolphin. It was in Encino. That meant it was near the carnival and I could pick it up later. Everybody's Happy Pastime was doing peak business by the time I got there. The midway was lit up like a sailor on shore leave. But where I went, it was dark. Out and back of the Zemansky sister's trailer, maybe I could pick up some proof that Dolly Zemansky pitched that night that killed Rand. I tripped over a tent rope and bumped into something. Wait a minute. Who are you?
What? I'm Borky.
Come on out in the light.
Yes, sir.
You're Pine.
Yes, sir, I'm Pine. Harold Pine. But they call me Porky. Porcupine. I reckon you could say it's a sort of a joke.
Porcupine?
It started when I was in college.
Yeah. My name's Regan, private detective.
Oh, I owe you an apology, Mr. Regan. At the car?
Skip it.
I thought you were Fred Rand.
Why were you gunning for him?
Fred Rand? Calls it Dolly.
Dolly Zeminski. You're going to marry her, aren't you?
Well, I...
What's on your mind?
Well, now that there's been a murder...
Go on.
I think I better tell the truth.
Good idea.
You asked me if I was going to marry Dolly.
Well,
I am married to her. San Bernardino. Last Thursday. My father, J.J. Pine, reckons Mr. Regan because of the family money...
Sure. You couldn't have married Dolly Zemanski. She was married to Fred Rand.
Not for 3 years.
Huh?
They was divorced, Mr. Regan.
You know that?
Well, Dolly had the decree. How else could we have got a marriage last?
Did you see the divorce decree?
Oh, yes, sir.
When was it granted?
1946.
Month, you remember?
Yes, October.
Day?
Well, Mr. Regan, I don't see
what...
What
day?
October 14th, 1946.
October 14th, 1946. Okay.
Well, Mr. Regan, I don't understand...
Rand showed up again, huh?
Yes, sir.
So you decided to kill him?
He was molesting Dolly.
Sure.
Well, maybe I'd just beat him up.
You're a kid, Pine.
Maybe I am.
You're keeping bad company.
I don't think so.
Who do you think knifed Fred Rand?
I don't rightly know.
What were you looking for in back of that trailer?
Nothing. I didn't think of anything.
You know Dolly's sister, Mary?
I do.
You think she killed Fred Rand?
No.
Then who did?
I don't know.
Okay, Pine. You didn't, anyway.
Well, maybe I was just pretending I didn't know he was dead when I fought with you at his car.
No, Porky. You're not that smart.
Mr. Regan, I reckon that's so.
Next stop was the Blue Dolphin Casino. The manager wasn't there, so I waited around. Must have been almost midnight before he showed. You're the manager, I am.
You bought it. In here.
You book acts?
Houston.
You ever hear of Duncan and Dolly? Night throwers?
Did they ever play us?
1946. Maybe, October?
I could look it up.
Okay.
Over here. Files, over here.
Yeah, plenty of cheesecake on the wall.
Oh, those pictures? Acts that have played us.
Yeah?
Yeah. Autograph photos. The Mandy boy, Mandy is me, were just scared to love. Dimples Davis. Dimples. You see what I mean?
Yeah. See what you mean.
Yeah. October 1946?
Could be.
No. No. Hey, wait a second. Last week of September. 26th through the 29th. Last week of September 1946, Duncan and Dolly...
Let me see that. Dolly Zemanski and Harry Duncan, King and Queen of the Blades. Split week booking, September 26th to 29th. 1946?
I'm thinking King and Queen of the Blades. Wait a second. Behind this locker. Yeah, photos all over the place. I'm just remembering. We keep the light on out where you can see it, but this stuff, you see... Yeah, like I'm remembering. The Mandy, sincerely, King and Queen of the Blades, Duncan and Dolly.
Let me see that picture.
Yeah. You recognize me?
Yeah, both of them. Dolly and Duncan.
Yeah? What'd it get you?
You guess me my answer. I made it fast back to the carnival. The midway was closed, but I could see a light on in one of the tents. I could hear voices. But when I walked in, the light went off.
Duncan. The light's back on.
That told me where they were. I started. Slow. I waited.
Duncan, don't. Put that knife down. Duncan's enough, man. We've enough.
All right, Duncan, I'm coming. The knife went past, took some air that belonged to me, and stuck in the tent pole. He shoved the table at me, and I shoved it back. He made a try for the tent door, and that was when I got it.
Hey, get off.
Turn the lights on, Dolly.
Harry Duncan, a phony swami.
It's a rat.
You should talk.
He okay?
He'll come out of it.
He killed Rand, thought I'd take the fall.
You let your sister take the fall and kept your trap shut because you were scared of what he knew.
Knew what?
Blue Dolphin Casino, end of September 1946.
How do you know that?
When you were supposed to be in Nevada divorcing Rand. You gotta stay there 6 weeks, baby. You can't even leave for one day. Figure it out. You're perjured in the Nevada courts. Your divorce is no good. When you married Harold Pine, you weren't divorced from Rand.
Guy, Regan.
You don't get Pine. I'll take care of that. Your marriage to him is good. Like a $3 bill.
Thanks. Maybe I can do something for you sometime.
So the swami killed Rand. That's what I figured wrong. If Mary didn't stick Rand, it had to be a toss job. Somebody had to toss that knife through the trailer window. Somebody professional. I figured you. Still, I saw that photo of Duncan and Dolly. Why'd he do it?
Because he hated Rand.
He loved you.
How'd you figure that?
Guys fall in love with dames like you. I don't know why.
We were a duo, Duncan and Dolly. We were going to get married, but I ditched him for Rand.
That figures.
Rand looked good a while. Dunk went on the bottle when I married Rand. Pretty soon he got too shaky for a knife act.
Ended up like this, the phony swami.
He said Rand had beat his time with me. He said he'd kill Rand if he got the chance. Didn't think he had the nerve.
He's coming out of it. Get out of here.
Yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't want to talk to Dunk. So long, Regan.
Get out of here! That wrapped it up for me. The police took it from there, and after a few hours at headquarters, I headed back to my apartment. But if I figured it was that easy to get rid of the lion, I was in for a new set of figures. The lion was there, waiting. Hat in hand.
Jeffrey, my boy, you've come back at last. I heard all about it. I've been waiting for you, Jeffrey.
Sure. Candle in the window.
Jeffrey, will you ever forgive me? Will you forget the unkind words I've uttered, the meaningless, petty things I've said? Oh, I rue the day I mistrusted you, Jeffrey, my boy. It was madness.
Come off it, fatso.
But, Jeffrey, I mean it. You were right all along. Mary didn't kill that man. Mary was an innocent girl caught in the tangled web of suspicion. But you, Jeffrey, you defended her in her most trying moments. A noble thing, Jeffrey.
But I'm fired.
Fired? Oh, nonsense, my boy, nonsense. Haven't I apologized? It's just that I feel so sad about that poor child, Mary, and that fine fellow without the bride he had taken to his heart. What will they ever do, Jeffrey?
Save your sympathy, Lion. They'll get along.
What? What do you mean by that?
Well, when I last saw them, they were sobbing it out on each other's shoulders.
You mean it, Jeffrey? They've discovered each other? How charming. How positively charming. And with all those millions he has, too. Millions of dollars.
Stop drooling, fatso. There's nothing in it for you.
No, Jeffrey, I suppose not. But I can dream, can't I?
Jeff Regan, Investigator, is written by William Frug and William Fifield, directed by Sterling Tracy, and stars Frank Graham as Regan, with Frank Nelson as Anthony J. Lyon. Original music is by Dick Arant.
Chesterfield, first cigarette in America to give you premium quality in both regular and king size, brings you Dragnet.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story you are about to hear is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent. You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned the homicide detail. A nightclub manager has been robbed and killed. The killers made good their escape. Their identity is unknown. Your job, get them. Dragnet.
the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case transcribed from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Wednesday, April 7th. It was warm in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of homicide detail. My partner's Frank Smith. The boss is Thad Brown, chief of detectives. My name's Friday. I was on the way back from R&I, and it was 1:46 p.m. when I got the interrogation room. Find anything?
No, they're checking it now.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Seaton?
Yes, Sergeant?
I wonder if you'd mind going over all that happened just once more. You might have forgotten something, some little thing that might help us here.
All right. Where do you want me to start? Where I came in this morning?
Yeah, that'll be fine.
Well, I came into work about 8:30.
Is that the time you usually get there?
Yes, sir. Depends what time I catch my bus. Usually it's about then, though.
Mm-hmm. Was Mr. Kelby there then?
Yeah, he usually gets in around 8 or so, comes in, looks the place over. You know, checks the register, liquor supply in the bar, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes to his office to count the money for the night before, get the deposit slip ready for the bank. That's what he was doing this morning when they came in.
You see him come in?
Yeah, I was in the kitchen when those two men came in.
Mm-hmm.
First, I thought they were salesmen. Both of them were dressed kind of nice. A lot of salesmen come in to see Kelby that time in the morning. I didn't figure anything was wrong.
They say anything to you, these men?
Well, no, not at first. They just stood there looking the place over. I went on peeling my potatoes. And then I heard one of them say that he guessed they might as well get it over with, and that's when they pulled the guns and told me it was a stick-up.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Well, first, I didn't know quite what to do. I asked if they was kidding, not to pull jokes like that, and I told him if it was a joke, it wasn't very funny.
Mm-hmm.
And then the big one came over and told me to keep my mouth shut, told me it wasn't any joke. And if I made a sound, they'd just soon blow my head off his look at me. Well, you just know I wasn't about to cause any trouble.
Did Mr. Kelby know they were in the place?
No, not then. You see, he keeps the door to his office closed when he's counting the money, and I thought about yelling to him, but then when I looked at those two guys, I thought about what they'd said about killing me. I decided not to.
What did these men do then?
The tall one walked over to the door of Mr. Kelby's office and knocked on the door. Mr. Kelby said for him to come in.
Mm-hmm.
They opened the door and walked in. He saw the guns, asked them what they wanted. Told them they'd better get out of there with those guns, not to cause any trouble. The little one laughed at him and said they wanted the money and that Kelby was the one who shouldn't cause any trouble.
Okay.
Go ahead. Well, the little one started to pick up the money and stuff it in his pockets, and Mr. Kelby told him they better leave it alone, that he had friends to take care of him. And the two of them said something I couldn't hear. Little one told Kelby that his friends wouldn't do him any good. And that's when they shot him.
Which one actually shot him?
Oh, the little one. He's the one who said that thing about the friends.
Well, did you try to do anything to help Kelby while all this was going on?
Well, what could I do? I told you what those guys said. Kelby wanted to be a hero, save the money. Fine, I wasn't his money. It belonged to the owners. But I tell you, Sergeant, money isn't worth that much. They nail you into that box and they don't throw a bankbook in. Those guys told me to stay put. I stayed put.
What did these two fellas do after they shot Kelby?
Well, the big one was real surprised, like he didn't know the little one was going to do it. Yelled at him he was a fool, said he was a stupid fool. Those were his exact words. And the little guy finished getting all the money, and then they ran out. Well, I'll tell you, I was scared to death they were going to kill me, too. It looked like it for a minute, too.
How do you mean?
Well, when they ran through the kitchen of the back door, the little one stopped and asked what they was going to do about me. I thought, sure, my number was up. Big one said not to make it any worse to leave me alone, then they ran out of the place. Boy, that's when I called the cops and those other guys, you know, out there in the car. And then you came. And the rest you know.
Are you sure that you've never seen any one of these men before?
No, sir, I'm pretty sure I haven't.
I wonder if you can give us some kind of a description on these two men.
Yeah, the big one was about 6 feet two, maybe three. Weighed about 180 to 200. Dark. Black curly hair.
Anything special about him? The way he talked? Any scars? Anything like that?
No, nothing.
How was he dressed, can you remember?
Yeah, he had on a gray suit. Glenn plaid, had kind of red in it, you know. The suit looked expensive. He had black shoes, a maroon tie.
Now, how about the smaller one? What did he look like?
Oh, he was a little one, 5'6" or 7", 130-35 pounds. He was dark, too, black hair, cut real short.
Mm-hmm. How about his clothes?
Had on a blue suit. Looked like a gabardine. Single-breasted, light blue. Had on a yellow shirt and dark blue tie.
Would you know if there were any marks or scars on him?
Oh, yeah. He had a little tiny scar right here on the edge of his mouth.
Uh-huh.
Made him look like he was smiling all the time.
Well, these are very good descriptions, Mr. Seaton. They're going to help us a lot here.
Yeah, well, like I said, I wasn't about to be a hero and try to stop these two, but I knew that you'd want to know what they looked like, so I tried to get all the dope I could.
We understand. Now, during the holdup, did either of these men use any names? One of them call the other by a name, anything like that?
Oh, let me think about that. Yeah. Yeah, there was something. While they were in the office, while the little guy was picking up the money, the big one said, hurry up, Deuce. Yeah, he called him Deuce.
That was a smaller one?
Uh-huh, that's right, Deuce.
Joe? Yeah. I'll ask the stats office to make a run on the descriptions and MO for us. Check the oddity and the Monica file in the R&I office and see if they can come up with a Deuce or anything on this guy.
That'll be fine, Frank. Thanks a lot.
Hey, you got cigarettes, Sergeant?
Yeah. Here you go.
Thanks. Yeah, how about Mac?
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a terrible thing. You know, Kelby being shot, I'll probably lose my job.
How's that?
I'll probably lose my job. The owners will figure, sure, I should have tried to stop those guys. Well, those are the breaks.
You said that when these men came in, the door to the manager's office was closed. Is that right?
Oh, yes, sir. Mr. Kelby always kept it closed when he counted the money, just like I said.
Uh-huh. Well, then it looks like the men knew that Kelby would be checking the money at that time, doesn't it? That they knew the layout of the place when they came in.
Yeah, you know, I never thought of that. By gosh, that's what must have happened. They sure seemed to know what was going on.
Anybody else that was usually around at that time, would you know? Anybody that might have known that the manager worked the accounts at that particular time?
No, there's nobody else around. But I don't think that Mr. Kelby kept it a secret about the money.
Was Kelby conscious at all after he was shot? Do you remember that?
Not more than a minute. I ran over to him right after the man left. I wanted to see if I could help, you know. And he was shot pretty bad. They'd hit him in the stomach. He was all doubled up. Terrible. He looked up at me and said, I know. And his voice kind of trailed off, that's all. Just, I know.
Stats office is making the run, Joe. Got out the local and the APB on the suspects. Nothing that matches the name Deuce and nothing on this car.
Anything from the crime lab yet?
No. Checked by the office. While I was there, Murphy called from Georgia Street.
Anything?
Yeah, not good.
What?
Kelby died, never regained consciousness.
With the death of the victim, any information he might have given us about his killers was gone. The one witness to the murder was shown the mug books but was unable to identify the suspect. Sergeants Gillen, Cenas, and Danny Galindo canvassed the neighborhood and came up with the driver of a bakery truck who thought he'd seen the killers leave the club. He told them that two men answering the description given us had walked out of the club and gotten into a late model Mercury sedan. He'd not been able to get the license number of the car, however. He was brought into the office and shown the mug books, but he was unable to point out the killers for us. In checking the neighborhood, Encinas and Galindo had come up with a waitress who had seen two men answering the description of the killers loitering around the area. She also described the Mercury sedan, but said that she hadn't paid much attention to it. Because of the smoothness with which the holdup men had operated, indications led us to believe that they had been tipped off by somebody working for the club. Proceeding with this theory, we checked with the club owner, a Mr. John Watson. We found him in the kitchen of his home.
Hope you don't mind if I finish up here, officers.
No, not at all, Mr. Watson.
Guess it seems a little silly to you for a man to be in the kitchen. Kind of a hobby of mine, cooking.
Yes, sir.
Making a cheesecake. Got some friends coming over tonight. Figure the cheesecake might taste good later in the evening.
Yes, sir. You go right ahead. We just have a few questions we'd like to ask you.
About the robbery? Terrible thing. I don't understand why Kelby just didn't give him the money. Not give him any reason to shoot.
Do you have any idea who might have known that the money would be in the office at the time?
And almost everyone that worked in the place. Not making mention of the salesman that came in. Would you hand me that rolling pin over there?
Yeah. Here you are.
Thanks. Crust to a cheesecake's important. That's one of the reasons I make it myself. Can't stand a soggy crust.
Are there any of your employees that you think might do a thing like this?
Well, that'd be hard to say. I didn't get around the club much. Once in a while, I'd drop by, chat with Kelby. He did the hiring and firing. As long as the place made money, I didn't interfere.
Mm. Well, the way it looks, it could be very likely that one of the employees did it. The men who pulled the job seemed to know just what they were doing.
That right?
Yes, sir. I wonder if we could look through your employment record.
Sure, of course. Anything I can do to help out in this thing. Would you hand me that pan over there?
Where? This one?
Yeah. Thanks. Get this crust into it and the cheesecake's about ready. Yeah, sure, you can look at the record. Don't see what that's going to show, but you're welcome to them.
What kind of a car do you drive, Mr. Watson?
New Lincoln. Just got it a couple of weeks ago.
Any of your employees drive a late model Mercury that you might know of?
No. Like I said, I don't really have a lot to do with the actual operation of the club. Kelby took care of that. Good manager. Did a fine job.
Can you tell us how much money they took, sir?
No. Near as we can tell, it came to a little over $1,100. Some of that was in checks, you know, that we cash for our customers. Well, that finishes that. Get this together. Now, get it in the oven. Looks good, doesn't it?
Yes, sir.
You should taste it. Set it for 350 for 25 minutes, and that does it. Yeah. Now then, can I get you offered anything? A cup of coffee or something like that?
No, sir. If you just arrange for us to check your employment record.
Certainly. I'll call the club right away.
We'd appreciate that.
My brother-in-law's down there looking after things now. He's an idiot. Never can get a job on his own. I only hired him because my wife insisted on it. Yeah, he'd probably botch up the whole thing. Usually does.
Well, if you'd call him, sir.
How's Kelby's condition? Going to be laid up long?
Well, Mr. Kelby's dead, sir. We thought you knew.
No, I hadn't heard. Oh, I can hardly believe it. Such a ruthless thing. Just terrible. Kelby was such a good man. Everybody that worked for him liked him. Didn't have an enemy in the world.
He had two. We went back 5 years into the employment records of the club. There were over 200 names. Each of them had to be checked out. Frank and I spent 2 months running them down. In all instances, the people interviewed had alibis or else they could explain their action at the time of the robbery and killing. In each instance, if the person owned an automobile, it was checked. A broadcast and an APB had been gotten out on the late model Mercury seen at the club, but there had been no answers. No replies had come in on the descriptions of the two suspects. June 17th, we were checking out the last three names on the list. One of the three, a David Adams, listed a rooming house on West 34th Street as his home address. We checked with a landlady, a Mrs. Elvia Collins.
Adams? Sure, he lives here, second floor front.
Wonder if we could talk to him, ma'am.
Sure, got no reason to say you can't. Come in.
Thank you, ma'am.
He isn't in right now. I went out about an hour ago. Said he had to lead on a job, and I sure hope he gets it. He's a couple of months behind in his rent. Sit down. Just take any chair.
Thank you, Miss Collins.
You officers lack anything? Mint on the table there. Help yourself.
No, thank you. Adams give you any idea when he might be back?
No, he didn't say right out. I expect he'll be here by 6.
How's that, ma'am?
That's when we serve dinner. Mr. Adams hasn't missed more than 4 meals since he's been living here.
What's this Adams look like?
Oh, little man. Sort of like my first husband, little dried up man.
Well, how old would you say he is?
Well, I know exactly. Baked his birthday cake last Wednesday. 46 candles and one for luck.
About how tall would you say, ma'am?
5'6" or so.
How about his weight?
820, and that has to be soaking wet. He's a real little man.
Is he dark or light?
I beg your pardon?
His hair, is it dark or light?
Oh, light. A real silky hair, what little there is left of it. Funny the way he combs it. Never could figure it out why a man would comb his hair that way.
What's that, ma'am?
Well, you see, he's only got a little bit of hair on one side. He lets it grow real long, and then he combs it all the way over the top of his head so it'll look like he's got a lot of hair. He really doesn't, though. He's silly. Well, he's pretty vain about other things, too.
Does he have any friends in the building, Miss Collins?
Well, there's his two cousins. They've moved, though.
How long ago did they move?
Well, let's see. Must have been about 2-3 months ago. Yeah, that much, anyway.
Well, what did these two cousins look like, Miss Collins? Can you describe them?
Well, you just bet I can. I had a lot of trouble with them, too. Always drinking. First one, he was a big one. 6 feet, anyway. Had dark hair. Weighed maybe 200 pounds.
Miss Collins, how about his complexion?
Dark.
Anything outstanding about him?
Well, now, what do you mean outstanding?
Well, I mean anything about him that struck you as being different, maybe. Anything that attracted your attention, something like that?
No.
Well, what about the number two man? How old was he?
Well, he was a little younger. 35, or maybe 37, around there.
Well, how tall would you say he was, Miss Collins?
Well, he was a little man. 5'6" or 7".
How much do you figure he weighed, would you know?
130 pounds or so.
How about his complexion?
Dark. Mm-hmm. Just like the other one.
Anything outstanding about him? Scars? Tattoos? Maybe anything like that?
Yes, he had a scar. Right on the corner of his mouth. Made him look like he was smirking all the time. It was a real dirty look.
What are these men's names, Miss Collins?
Well, now the big one is called Al Evans.
Uh-huh.
The little one's name was Bill Evans. They was brothers.
Did they have a car?
Oh, yes, a late one. It was real pretty.
You know what make it was?
No. No, I'm sorry, but I can't tell one kind from another. Sure was a nice looking one, though. A lot of chrome all over it.
Do you have any idea where they might be now, where they moved to?
No, I haven't. Well, Mr. Adams can probably tell you, though.
I see.
Oh, that might be him now. I'll see.
Oh, we'll go with him, ma'am, all right?
Are you expecting any trouble? What's this all about, anyway? Mr. Adams done something wrong? Oh, I do hope not. He's a little man, but he's awfully nice.
We'd just like to talk to him.
Oh, I sure hope they won't be any trouble. Oh, Mr. Adams.
Yes, Miss Collins?
These gentlemen would like to talk to you.
Oh? Nothing I can do for you?
Are you David Adams?
Yes, sir, that's right.
We're police officers, Mr. Adams. My name's Friday. It's my partner, Frank Smith.
How do you do? Adams. What is it you wanted?
Well, it might be better if we talked in your room.
All right, but I still don't see what it is you want.
Did you get the job?
No, Mrs. Collins, but I've got another lead. Don't worry, I'll be able to take care of that matter by the first next week.
Oh, it's all right, Miss Adams. I understand.
This is it. Not much. Just sit down anywhere.
Thank you.
You want to tell me what this is all about now? What it is that you want with me?
Well, we'd like to talk to you about the robbery of the Pink Rat Cafe last April. Manager was killed.
The Pink Rat, yes. I worked there a couple of years ago, but I don't think I've been in the place since then. I lost the job. Kelby fired me for dropping a load of dishes.
Did you have an argument at the time?
Well, a little one, yeah. I was sore. He was, too. Wanted me to pay for the dishes. I didn't feel it was my fault. I told him so. He had a few words. Nothing serious, though. Why?
Mr. Kelby was killed in a holdup at the bar.
Yes, I know. That's too bad. But you surely don't think I had anything to do with that, do you?
Well, that's what we're trying to find out.
Why do you think I'd have anything to do with it? I haven't been near the place for a couple of years.
Well, the way the thing was pulled, the whole M.O. makes it look like it's an inside job. Somebody had to give the layout, tell him that Kelby would be in his office with the money at that time. It all points to somebody that either works there now or who did work there.
Yes, but why me?
Well, your name was on the list. It had to be checked out. Adams, you got any relatives in town?
Not now. I had a couple of cousins. They were out here for a while.
What are their names?
Al and Bill Evans.
Mind if we look around your room?
No, I didn't know you high. Go ahead and look around. You won't find anything.
Thanks.
What is it about my cousins? You figure they had something to do with the thing?
Well, we think they might have. Their descriptions match the ones we got from the witnesses.
You've been talking to old Mrs. Collins. She's the one who told you about Alan Bell, isn't she?
Well, who told us isn't important, Adam?
Well, you don't have to admit it, I know. A busybody always getting a nose into somebody else's business. Oh, harpy.
Joe?
Yeah?
Look at here.
What's this gun for, Adam?
You never know when somebody's going to try to break into the house. It's protection, that's all.
Mm. You never had it out of the house, huh?
Not since I bought it. It's a .32, though. What are you so interested for? Kelby was killed with a .38. Well, he was, wasn't he? Seems to me I heard it on the radio or read it in one of the papers.
No, you didn't. The caliber of the gun that killed him wasn't released. How'd you know?
I must have read it in the paper, like I said.
No, this won't work, mister. I think maybe we better talk to you downtown, huh?
You going to arrest me?
Just like to talk to you downtown. Let's go.
Well, sure, but I got nothing to hide.
Well, you still got to come up with an explanation for knowing about that gun.
Description we got matches your cousins. You know about the gun. You got a lot to explain.
I don't want to go to jail.
Too bad, Adam. You should have thought about that before you got involved in this.
Well, if I tell you, if I help you get the guys that did it, will you give me a break?
Well, we can't make any deal.
Well, I don't want to go to jail. You can't do anything for me, huh?
All we can do is see that the district attorney's office knows that you've helped.
But you'll tell him, huh? If I give you a hand.
He'll know about it.
Okay. I got claustrophobia putting me in a cell and drive me nuts. I'll tell you who did the job. More than that.
Yeah.
I can show you the gun they used.
You are listening to Dragnet, the authentic story of your police force in action. Listen to what the nation's press has had to say about Chesterfields. Atlantic City Evening Union. Wholesalers and retailers report an extraordinary demand for Chesterfields in both sizes, with sellouts in many instances. Cleveland Press. Dealers everywhere report the big pack sale phenomenal. Last week in Cleveland, some areas reported the long size Chesterfield outsold all other brands.
And from all over the country, we're getting reports from dealers telling us no product they ever handled has grown so fast in so short a time as king size Chesterfields.
Yes, with a buying public today, high quality for the money is a must. And that's why so many smokers are changing to Chesterfield. First cigarette in America to give you premium quality in both regular and king size. King size Chesterfield is exactly the same as regular Chesterfield, except it's larger. Contains so much more of the same tobacco, it gives you a 21% longer smoke, yet costs very little more.
And the tobacco in king size Chesterfield is of better quality and higher price than the tobacco in any other king size cigarette.
Try Chesterfield. Either way you like them, regular or king size, they're much milder. Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
We took David Adams back to the office and checked the gun with pawn shop records. It was clean. We printed him and checked him through R&I. We took him over to Westlake Park and he showed us the approximate place on the lake where the gun had been thrown. He explained that his two cousins had talked him into helping him with the robbery at the club. He also said that as soon as he found out that there'd been a shooting, he'd washed his hands of the entire affair and told them that he'd have nothing more to do with it. The loot from the robbery had been divided between the two cousins, Adams taking no part of it. It took us 2 hours of searching before we were able to find the gun. It was turned over to Russ Camp in ballistics. He fired test shots from the gun, and comparison with the death bullet showed that it was the murder weapon. Markings on the shell casing found at the scene of the crime were the same as those left on the test casing. Adams told us that Bill Evans owned a late model Mercury sedan and that the two brothers had left for St. Louis in the car. He also was able to give us the license number. We checked with DMV and they told us that the legal owner was a finance company on Crenshaw. The manager there told us that their payments were up to date. They were able to give us a St. Louis address used as a reference by Bill Evans. We called the St. Louis Police Department, gave them a rundown, and asked them to pick up the Evans brothers for us. The witness to the killing was unable to identify David Adams as one of the holdup men. He was taken to the main jail and booked on suspicion of 287 PC. Frank and I waited for word from the St. Louis Police Department.
They're all the same, aren't they, Joe?
What do you mean?
I put any of them in a tight spot and they'll spill all I know to save their skins.
Well, it seems that way, doesn't it?
Adams seems pretty sincere, though. Seems like he does really want to help.
Well, we'll know more when we hear from St. Louis.
They figure that Adams is telling the truth?
I don't know. The story seems to check out about how he laid the thing out for him, showing us where the gun was. Being that far back in his room, Red, it'd make that part about him not taking any of the money fit. I'll get it. Homicide, Friday. Yeah, I'll take it. Mello. Yeah. Yeah, we've been waiting to hear from you. Did you pick up the Evans brothers? Uh-huh. Yeah, wait a minute. Toss me that pad, will you, Frank?
Yeah, here.
Thanks. Yeah, all right, go ahead. Uh-huh. What was that again? I didn't... Yeah, I got it. Okay, thanks. Anything we can do for you, give us a call. Yeah, sure, we sure appreciate it. Right, bye.
What does it? What do you mean?
St. Louis checked the address. They'd been there all right, but they left this morning.
Any idea where they went?
Yeah, the Evans boys told us.
Huh?
They left a forwarding address. Motel out on Ventura Boulevard. Frank and I notified Captain Lorman of the new developments. We talked to the manager of the motel, and she told us that she did have a reservation for June 24th under the name Evans. She told us that they'd be in Cottage 12. In view of the fact that the suspects had not been alarmed, we decided not to put out an APB on the car. We felt reasonably sure that having made the reservations, they'd keep them. But in the event the suspects arrived earlier than expected, a surveillance was placed on the motel 24 hours a day. Sergeants Howard Hudson and Bill Cummings took the period from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., Frank and I covered the other 12 hours. Directly across from the motel was a used car lot. We talked to the manager, and he gave us permission to sit in any one of his cars while keeping the place under surveillance. As we relieved each other, the police car was taken back to the city hall, so there would be no indication that the place was staked out. 4 days passed. No sign of the suspect. June 23rd, 4:32 a.m.
Joe.
Yeah, Mercury sedan. License checks. Two men.
Stopping at the manager's cottage. Ringing the bell.
Yeah. Looks like they're signing the register.
It must be.
There.
He's giving them the key.
All right, let's let him get to the cottage. We told her we went.
All right.
Well, there's the landlady's signal. Let's go.
Right.
This is the manager. Gonna have to move your car.
Huh?
You gotta move your car. Put it in the back.
What do you want, Stan? Come,
Bill! Hey, Joe, get the other one.
Yeah.
Get away from the cop. Leave me alone.
All right, give it up, mister.
I'm getting out. You got any brains here? I'm trying to stop
you. You're going no place, mister. You can't get over that wall. Throw that gun out here. You haven't got a chance.
Not sure, Archer. You'll never take me.
All right, hold it up, Evan. All right.
No gun. I dropped it. You see, I got no gun. Get a doctor for me, huh? Or it hurts.
Yeah, we'll call one.
You didn't have to shoot, did you? Lousy deal, you didn't have to shoot.
You didn't give me much choice, mister.
I wasn't trying to hit you, just trying to scare you, that's all. I didn't want to hit you. I'm a good shot. I knew what I was doing.
Yeah, you proved you're a good shot.
What do you mean?
When you killed Kelby.
The story you have just heard was true. The names were changed to protect the innocent.
On October 4th, trial was held in Superior Court, Department 87, City and County of Los Angeles, State of California. In a moment, the results of that trial. Nose, throat, and accessory organs not adversely affected by smoking Chesterfield. First such report ever published about any cigarette.
Yes, and it applies only to Chesterfield. A responsible consulting organization has reported the results of a continuing study by a competent medical specialist and his staff on the effects of smoking Chesterfield cigarettes. A group of people from various walks of life was organized to smoke only Chesterfields. For 6 months, this group of men and women smoked their normal amount of Chesterfields, 10 to 40 a day. 45% of the group smoked Chesterfields continually from 1 to 30 years, for an average of 10 years each. At the beginning and at the end of the 6 month period, each smoker was given a thorough examination, including x-ray pictures, by the medical specialist and his assistants. The examination covered the sinuses as well as the nose, ears, and throat. The medical specialist, after a thorough examination of every member of the group, stated, quote, "It is my opinion that the ears, nose, throat, and accessory organs of all participating subjects examined by me were not adversely affected in the 6 month period by smoking the cigarettes provided," unquote. Now remember this Chesterfield report. It's the first such report ever published about any cigarette.
Nose, throat, and accessory organs not adversely affected by smoking Chesterfields.
Buy Chesterfield either way you like them, regular or king size. Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
William M. Evans and Alfred T. Evans were tried and convicted of murder in the first degree. They received life sentences in the state penitentiary. Because David R. Adams had turned state's evidence, and since he was not actually involved in the crime, in the interest of justice, the charges against him were dismissed and he was released from custody. This program is dedicated to the 59th Annual Conference of the International Association of Chiefs of Police, held in Los Angeles this week. Just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice comes from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department. Technical advisors, Captain Jack Donahoe, Sergeant Marty Wynn, Sergeant Vance Frazier. Heard tonight were Ben Alexander, Virginia Gregg, Jack Crucian. Script by John Robinson. Music by Walter Schumann. Hal Gibney speaking.
These great programs sound off for Chesterfield. Radio, Dragnet, the Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis Show, and every weekday, Arthur Godfrey time. On television, Dragnet, Gangbusters, Arthur Godfrey and his friends in the Perry Como Show.
Tomorrow, you'll want to sound off for Chesterfields, because either way you like them, regular or king size, Chesterfield gives you the best possible smoke.
Chesterfield has brought you Dragnet, transcribed from Los Angeles.
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
This one's about Pete Kelly. Cut whiskey and a seven-piece band.
We start every night at 10 and we play till 6 in the morning. It's not much, but the contract runs out in June 1924. After that, there's a place in South Chicago that may take us. In the meantime, we're working here on Cherry Street. The lease is made out to George Lupo. His brother gave it to him after the funeral. The kind of music we play started out as a backroom exercise in a little swamp stop called Myrtle Grove. La Rocca took his Dixieland band to Reisenweber's in New York. We got as far as Kansas City. It's no place to get off a train unless you're a sack of mail. Because around here, everybody works at the same job, staying alive. Half a buck buys a pair of socks, a spaghetti dinner, or a down payment on murder. Well, last night, everything turned sour about midnight. The town was down on its hands and knees trying to crawl through one of those Kansas City hot spells that blast by every third day. It was heat and headaches all the way. Our drummer Nick was dragging the beat, and I went bad 12 bars in on the Memphis Blues. Now, I figured we better cut the set short, so we started to fight our way through one chorus of Roses of Picardy. That's when the kid came in and stood for the bandstand. He was tall enough to see over a quart of milk with a face the size of a minute and just about as young. Let's get off for a while.
Who's your friend, Pete?
I don't know, but he must be tone deaf.
Mr. Tilly!
Yeah, son?
I heard you play. You sound good.
We've been better. What's on your mind?
Father Cronin sent me to see you.
Are you doing a little missionary work?
Oh, no, sir, nothing like that. I'm an altar boy over there. Father calls me Little Jake.
I sure got you working the late shift.
I've been trying to get a hold of you all day. Father wants a favor.
I'll make it a small one. I'm all out of the big ones.
And he just wanted to know if you could come by St. Timothy's and see him. He said tomorrow morning right after the 9 o'clock.
Okay. Tell him he keeps terrible hours. I'll be there.
Thanks, Mr. Kelly.
Hey, Kelly.
Yeah, that's right.
Tell the kid goodbye.
He knows his way out.
Should I go, Mr. Kelly?
Be the kid.
Yes, sir. Goodbye, Mr. Kelly.
Yeah, goodbye, Jay.
You got someplace private we'd like to talk?
This is my office.
Now, listen hard, Bright Eyes. There's enough gun in this coat to blow you right through the wall.
I'll take your word for it.
We come in here nice and you get funny mouth.
Now, you got someplace we can talk?
I can't leave. I got to do a number.
Do it.
We'll be right here about 10 feet from your stomach.
Yeah. All right. Let's go.
You look sick, Pete. What's the matter?
I feel fine. Who's sorry now? Everybody ready? Let's go.
Now, let's go.
Yeah. Keep them going, Red.
How many shall we do, see?
If this works out, about 10 minutes worth. Let's go.
Yeah, we'll do. We need a favor, Kelly.
Yeah, there's a run on them tonight.
Give me the envelope, Dix.
Yeah.
You got an inside coat pocket, Kelly?
Come on, either throw or pass the dice.
Hold him, Dix. Pull him up, Dix.
Come on. Up.
Yeah. Now, this is how. Here's an envelope. It goes in your inside coat pocket and it stays there until 6 o'clock tomorrow night. You don't open it. You don't mess with it.
What happens at 6 o'clock?
You'll be the first to know.
Well, I stood down the alley and watched them walk away. Inside, Lupo was blowing up a storm, something about paying for a seven-piece band and only having six. Well, it wasn't worth trying to get back on the stand. I got a cab and went up to my room. I tried to get to sleep. It was no good. I got up. I was sick to my stomach. After that, I went to sleep. The next morning, I made a pass at some breakfast and tried to look through the sports page. Harry Heilman got 4-for-5 against the Red Sox, but that's all I read. That envelope had me. People have been taken out in alleys before, and they've been worked over, usually to get something away from them, not to give it to them. No matter how I tried to put it together, it wouldn't come out. Thin or fat, it wouldn't slice. I had the envelope, and I had to wait till 6 o'clock. Well, I gave up on the coffee, and I started over to see Father Cronin. It was a little after 9:30 when I started up the steps of St. Timothy's. I figured Mass was almost over, so I hung around in the vestibule for a couple of minutes, trying to look like a part-time bell ringer.
Hi, Mr. Kelly.
Hello, Jake.
Father's back in the sacristy, Mr. Kelly. He said for me to show you the way.
They move it?
No, sir.
All right, Jake. Show me the way.
This way, Mr. Kelly. Down this aisle.
Well, I guess I was too busy trying to act like I knew my way around to pay much attention to a fat, chunky little guy wearing a brown Borsellino hat. He stood up in a back pew a couple of aisles over. The church was empty except for the three of us. Little Jake found out about it just before I did.
Mr. Kelly, that man back there.
All right, mister. I'll take that envelope.
Jake, get out.
Mr. Kelly, look out! Look out!
Kansas City, you learn early to look for trouble, any place, any time, but this is the first time it caught up with me in the middle of a church. The last three shots were a waste of money. Jake went down like young wheat in a hailstorm. When I grabbed for him, I hit my head on the base of a marble pillar. I lost the edge right there. By the time I hit the street, he was gone. I guess I covered every alley and street in the neighborhood, but it was like trying to wash a pail of dirty water. I don't know how much later it was when I stopped for a minute in an empty doorway and tried to remember what I was chasing. Well, a siren was crying off somewhere in the distance, and I started back for the church. The coroner's wagon was just pulling away as I got there. I didn't see Father Cronin around, so I went back to the rectory and rang the bell. He came to the door in his shirt sleeves. He stood there for a minute just looking at me. Then he motioned me inside.
In here. Sit down.
The kid, Father, little Jake.
He's dead. You want to blow by blow?
Yeah, I know, Father. I was there.
Sure you were there. You're always there. I should have known better than to call you. I should have known it meant trouble.
Oh, wait a minute, Father. This wasn't my party.
I called you here today to ask you a favor, Pete.
Yeah, I know.
You don't know. It's too late now. We were going to have an altar boys picnic tomorrow at Washington Park. I wanted you to play a little music for us. We won't be going now, Pete. We got a funeral instead.
Yeah. What do you want me to say?
Don't say anything, Pete. If you've got any private fights, that's your business. But don't bring your beef into the church.
I never saw the guy before, Father.
Don't kid me. He didn't come in here to shoot little Jake.
Now, look, I know this is hard to understand.
You bet it's hard to understand. We've been over it before, but you ran with the same pack. You hung on to the same friends. You had it all figured out. Well, you figured this one, Pete. There's a 9-year-old boy on his way to the moor. He took a gangster's bullet that you earned. Now you go ahead. Figure it.
I got this envelope.
I don't want an explanation. Take your excuses and peddle them where you need them. For the bootleggers and the gunmen. Take them to your crowd.
This envelope, Father, they shoved it in my pocket. I was out in the alley behind the club. Two guys, they worked me over. I didn't think they'd try anything like this.
Neither did little Jake.
All right, Father, I told you I was sorry.
Go on home.
Why don't you stop cutting at me and say a prayer for that kid?
I would, but I'm too busy praying for people like you.
Well, you couldn't blame him. How do you explain away a dead kid lying in front of an altar rail? All I could offer was a 2-cent envelope in my coat pocket and a wild night in an alley. I started to walk back to my room. I tried to paste up some kind of an answer, but I got nothing. I was halfway home when the last breeze left town and went someplace to cool off. My clothes were soaking wet, and I decided to take a cab the rest of the way. I reached in my pocket, and all I had was 23 cents, so I kept walking. Sunday morning's the same in any town. Empty streets and everybody home trading the comic section and living off of Saturday night. You can live here all your life, and on Sunday morning you just got in town. It was about noon when I got to my hotel. I went up to the second floor and unlocked my door. They were sitting on the bed. Their coats were off, and they'd hung them on the back of a chair. The same two boys who'd given me the envelope last night.
Got a real hot room here, Kelly. You want to move off this court?
Yeah, next time I'll get twin beds.
Is everything all right with that envelope?
It
made a murder, mister. You take it.
Put it back in your pocket.
Now get this, both of you. There's a lot of something wrong here. I've had my turn. You find yourself another fall guy. There's a lot of inside coat pockets in this town. Look for a new one.
We like yours, and that's where it's going to stay. Now, you don't listen good. Me and Dex put it out last night, and you didn't pick up on it. We got you on board, and we'll tell you when to get off.
6 o'clock, boy.
How long do you think this jag will last? Look, I'm cashing in. I've had enough.
What were you doing this morning, trying to pray your way out?
A priest wanted a favor.
I got it, Lon.
Yeah. Yeah, you can. No, he's busy. From 2 to 5. Sure, come on up.
Benny.
He went for it, huh?
On his way up. We're going to stay a while, Kelly.
Well, there's only 3 chairs. I'll make it easy for you.
Stay put, mister.
No, he's your friend. I'm checking out.
First time you've been right.
Well, it happened so fast, I didn't even see his arm move. My knees buckled and I pitched forward. I don't know how long I laid there, but when I opened my eyes, the afternoon sun was almost gone. What was left of it was bleeding through a rip in the blind. Well, I could hear somebody breathing hard like a fat man on a hot day, and when I rolled over, I saw him. A tough prohibition agent by the name of Cage. The weather didn't make any difference to Cage. He always looked that way. His collar was wilted, and it looked like Arrow's first try. His necktie was pulled down, and the knot was twisted. The heat had worked him over so that the front of his shirt was splotchy and damp. Reminded you of a first grader's map of the world. He was sitting in a chair with his arms draped over the back and his head resting on his hands. He was smoking a Milo Violet, but it didn't help that much. His mouth was wound around a toothy grin, and he looked like a mountain lion who'd just eaten her young.
You can get up now, Keller. You made your point.
Yeah, sure. How long you been here?
Long enough to fill out your book and slip. You're going to jail, mister.
What for? Sleeping on the floor?
For the dead guy on the bed. Who is he?
I don't know. How'd he get there?
You put him there after you shot him. Now get your hat.
Look, prohibition's your racket. Dead bodies are out of your line.
Not when I find him in your room. Now let's go downtown. We'll both tell homicide. We'll find the details later.
Gage, you couldn't find yourself in a mirror. I didn't have anything to do with this, and you know it. I've been out for the last 3 hours. This happened after they slugged
me. Save it for the jury. All I know is I got a phone tip to check room 205. I come up here and I find you and a dead guy. That's all I need. You can dress it up fancy and make it look cute, but it still comes out.
There's enough liquor in this town to float it away, and you're wasting your time with a killing that's none of your business.
You're my business, big shot. Somebody put 2 pounds of lead in Benny's chest, and you're my pick.
Benny who?
Benny Davis. He worked for Mike Quinlan. You look pale.
Yeah, I'm just beginning to feel a squeeze. Mike Quinlan on one side and those 2 trigger men that you let walk out of here on the other.
You got it, and I'll be turning a handle.
Now, before you start worrying about your picture in the paper, you better turn up the 2 guys that were here with me.
That part of the same dream?
They gave me an envelope to hold for him. The price on it's going up with a minute. A 9-year-old kid died for it, and this guy here on the bed.
That's a good story. Do you write him down or just make him up?
Look, you got nothing on me, and I haven't got much time. I'm leaving you.
That's all right. I call downtown. The minute you hit the street, they'll pick you up.
In the meantime, you better come up with more than you got. They don't hang you in this state on a hunch.
I'm going to check this room over. I'll find all we need.
You couldn't find your head with both hands. Goodbye, Cage.
All right, you got till midnight, big shot, and then I'll be around.
Yeah.
I'll have it all set up. All we'll need is time to run the extra.
Well, I could have used a cold shower, but with Cage there, I didn't have the room to dry off. I went down the hall and headed down the back stairs. I figured even if Cage was right about calling downtown, I might have an edge if I moved fast enough. The sun was on the downgrade, but it didn't make any difference. It'd done a good job all day, and the heat was boiling up out of the ground. So if I was going to come out at all, I had to have some help. So I started to look for the only honest guy I know, an ex-bootlegger by the name of Barney Ricketts. The only bootlegger in the country that went broke in 1922. He drank himself out of business. I phoned 8 different places and tried 4. Nobody'd seen him. I was about ready to give up when I finally found him sitting in the middle of a bourbon fog in a little Spanish joint somewhere on the edge of the East Bottom. He was sitting at a back table trying his best to make time with a plaster bust of Queen Isabella.
Ah, Petey, my boy, you're just in time. I'm not quite certain, but I think the young lady here has a friend.
I gotta talk to you, Barney.
If you're any good at all with Spanish, now is the time. I was positive she'd loosen up on this second bottle of wine, but no, she's utterly uncharitable, and I think she's a picture of a perfect boy.
Yeah, all right, Barney.
To a member of the old Castilian school, there can be no excuse for the conduct she's exhibited.
Yeah.
Why, do you know I was even good enough to buy her 3 rounds of Portuguese brandy? Imported, mind you. But what do I get for my pains? Not even a civil thank you.
Listen to me, will you, Barney?
I've been sitting here in the most gentlemanly fashion, sipping this delicate nectar and trying vainly to keep the party going. But does she help? No! I've talked to her about politics, medicine, literature, Keats, Byron, Shelley, Faith Baldwin. I've even talked about the weather.
Barney, she's a statue.
Oh, a simple oversight, Petey. It could happen to anyone.
Now, look, I'm in trouble.
Of course you're in trouble. You'll always be in trouble because you're a child of adversity, a son of scorn. The fates. spit in your eye and you try to retaliate, but the wind's always blowing in the wrong direction. You're a lost leaf in the mortal storm, Petey. You're a pebble shaking a tiny fist at the mountain. You'd like to fight for some strange, fantastic cause, wouldn't you? But you can't find anybody your size. Men are too small and the gods are too big. Petey, you're lost.
You all through now?
Yes. What kind of trouble?
A pair of bum murder raps. Somebody slugged me in my room and I woke up with a dead guy.
Dubious honor. You mentioned two murders.
One of them was an altar boy over at St. Timothy's. The other guy worked for Mike Quinlan.
The same Quinlan that controls most of the Canadian import here in town?
Yeah, that's him.
Time's short. Let's finish the brandy.
Two guys started all this at the club last night. Names are Ludd and Dex. Mean anything to you?
This'll all sound better with more brandy. You picked two of Quinlan's first string. Ludd Sandell and Dex Porter, both killers.
Look, they gave me an envelope to hang on to. Now nose around. See if you can find out what it all means. The dead guy up in my room, his name's Benny Davis. See if you can find out where he fits in, will you?
It'd be a lot simpler if you just joined Quinlan's gang. Benny Davis holds a card in the same organization.
Well, how about Ludd and Dex? Any bad blood between them and
Davis? If there is, it doesn't show. They're closer than unborn peas.
You sure about that, Barney?
Police blotter can't be that wrong. Benny's sister will tell you the same thing.
Well, where do I find her?
Chelsea Apartments. Beautiful girl, Petey. When you're my age, she'll disturb your memories.
All right, now get going, will you? See how close you can get to Quinlan's headquarters. Find out what you can about Ludd and Dex and Benny Davis. Maybe Quinlan's got him on a special job or something. Find out what it is, will you?
You find me in a temporary economic slump, Petey. I'll need carfare.
Yeah, well, that makes two of us. I'm broke. You'll have to do it on foot.
Oh, well, I have friends here. My credit's unlimited.
Well, hurry up, will you, Barney?
One moment. Alfonso, would you loan me a dollar and a half?
Come on, let's go.
He's only bluffing. He won't shoot.
Well, Barney headed down toward Bale Street for Mike Quinlan's place, and I started cross town for the North End and the Chelsea Apartments. I couldn't begin to work it out. If Dex and Ludd were such good friends with Benny Davis, why did they kill him? And if they didn't do it, who planted his body in my room and why? Well, I was running way late and there wasn't much time to catch up. I finally found the Chelsea Apartments on the corner of Stocker and Bale's with an old three-story wooden frame. I checked the mailbox and Louise Davis was down for apartment 17. Well, inside, the hallway was dark and a couple of gas jets were smoking up the ceiling. There was a potted palm by the foot of the stairs and it looked like it was growing out of old gum wrappers and cigar butts. Apartment 17 was at the rear of the first floor. She answered the door and you could tell right away Barney was right. She was pretty and she had enough smile to last you for years.
Yes?
You Louise Davis?
That's right. I can do better for you. You're Pete Kelly. I've heard you play.
Yeah, well, so far you're batting 1,000. Can I come in?
Yeah, sure. You didn't bring your band, so it must be a social call.
I'll make this short. It's about Benny.
What about him?
That's what I want to know. He's got a couple of friends. I got to know about him.
Benny isn't that popular. You mean Ludd and Dex?
They'll do. They got trouble and they're cutting me in.
What kind of trouble?
Well, I'm not sure. That's why I came to you.
I can't help you. They never tell me what they're doing.
Well, they gave me an envelope. They told me to hold it till 6 o'clock tonight.
You haven't got any problem. You'll know in an hour.
Yeah, well, maybe I'm tired. I want to know now. I'll take any lead you got.
They found out I told you this. They might not like it. They got some kind of a beef with Quinlan.
Does Mike know about it?
I wouldn't know. I just heard him talking one night. They're not happy with the money Quinlan gives them.
They got any plans?
I don't think we've got to talk about this. Let me get you a drink, huh?
Now, look, this is the last trip around for me, lady. I got to have everything you know.
You said something about an envelope, didn't you?
That's right.
You got it?
Right here.
If you open it, you'll understand everything.
Well, they gave it to me sealed. They want it back the same way.
If you want to be around to give it back, you'd better open it.
You got a guarantee handy?
All I know is the three of them are working on something big. I don't know what it is, but I heard some talk about an envelope. It's your choice. You ask for a lead and you got it.
Yeah, we'll hold hands when they cut me down. You got a letter opener?
Pete, look out!
Well, it all happened faster than a Mexican divorce. Louise Davis was dead before the echo left the room. Well, I got to the window, but whoever did the shooting was gone. I grabbed the envelope, and on my way out, I took another look at her. There wasn't anything left but the smile. I cut through a couple of back lots and down an alley. I stopped in the doorway and opened the envelope. Inside was a handful of typewritten sheets. Looked like a lot of headache for five pieces of paper. And then the bell rang. Two of them were consignment slips for 8,000 gallons of high-grade Canadian whiskey. The other three slips were detailed breakdowns for a convoy of trucks. They showed special truck routes over the Canadian border into the States to miss the hijackers and the prohibition agents. They showed a day-by-day schedule for each truck on its trip down from the border. Well, it's not too tough to hijack a load of booze, but when you got it laid out right down to the time, the place, and how many bottles, it's like money in the bank. Well, I knew right then why the envelope meant so much to Ludd and Dex. What I couldn't understand was where they got it. Why they gave it to me to hang on to. Well, maybe they were working for Quinlan, but why didn't he have the papers, and why weren't they in his safe? Mike had a big one. Well, the questions were still piling up. It was an outside chance, but I couldn't stand still, so I crossed over to the Kansas side and headed down Boulder Road to Fat Annie's place. Maggie Jackson did two things good. She sang the blues better than the guy who wrote them, and she could pick up an idle rumor at 3 miles.
Hi, Pete.
Maggie, what do you know?
I knew you'd be here tonight. You always come in together. Trouble and Pete Kelly.
Yeah, I know. I never come around except when I need something.
As long as I have it to give, you got it. It's Mike Quinlan this time, ain't it?
Well, that's part of it. I'm in it up to my ears.
You got an envelope, I heard.
Yeah?
Mike Quinlan and some of his boys have been here about an hour ago. They tore the paper off the walls looking for you and Dex and Ludd.
Dex and Ludd?
Mike wants all three of you.
Yeah, anything else?
No. Bonnie Ricketts called for you.
Did he leave a number?
He's still waiting on the phone. I took the call. He said you'd end up here, so he just hung on.
Well, I'll get it right now.
Yeah, the boss is kind of mad. The phone's been tied up for 2 hours.
All right, thanks, Maggie.
Sure, and good luck, Pete.
Hello, Barney.
There you are, Petey.
That'll be $1.25 for another 3 minutes.
Yes, all right, operator. Alfonso, 5 more quarters, please. No, no, the quarters. Just a minute, Petey. Alfonso doesn't know the quarters from the house.
Yeah, well, hurry up. What's going on, Barney? Where are you?
Fort Madison, Iowa. I'm troubleshooting for you, Pete.
Well, what'd you find out?
It's a double cross. Mike Quinlan's involved in one of the biggest deals of his career, and Benny Davis, along with Dex and Lutz, stole the consignment papers.
Yeah, I know. That's what's in the envelope.
You better get them back to Quinlan. I understand he's been tearing up the town for them.
Well, what do I do about Dex and Lutz?
She might easily end up like Benny Davis. Seems Lutz and Dex didn't want to split it 3 ways, so they killed him.
You sure about all this?
That's why I'm up here in Iowa.
No, I'll see you when you get back.
It's been a gay, mad world, Petey. We drove 60 miles an hour all the way up here.
Yeah?
Alfonso's drunk. He thinks the phone's a slot machine. He's waiting for the payoff.
Well, as soon as I hung up the phone, everything fell into place. I had one big worry, to get back to the club and unload those papers before Quinlan caught up with me. Well, almost everything made sense now, except the killing of Louise Davis, Benny's sister. It was easy to see why they dropped Benny along the way, but why his sister? How did she tie in? Well, on the way back to town, I mulled over a couple of possibilities, and I figured maybe I came up with the answer. I started back for town, and it was rough all the way. I kept thinking any minute I'd bump into Mike Quinlan, and I couldn't be sure that I'd lost Dex and Ludd. It was almost dark by the time I got back to the club. The band was waiting around for the Sunday rehearsal. We ran through one number, and then things got cloudy.
Now, Kelly.
You're early, Dex.
Close enough.
No, not for me. You said 6 o'clock.
Your horn's no match for this gun. Give me the envelope.
6 o'clock, Dex. All right. Let's try someday, sweetheart. Hand me that plunger, will you, Red? I'll give you the pickup.
Pack up. I'll see you at 10.
Did You going to give me that envelope, or do I blow it out of your pocket?
The same way you handled Louise Davis?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I think you do. You killed her, and you killed her brother.
You got it all figured out, haven't you, Kelly?
The horn player's right, Dex. Don't turn around.
You got it wrong, Lud.
I don't think so. I never should have let you kill Benny. That should have been the tip-off, and that kid in the church and Benny's sister. You had to make the big try.
It was for me and you, Lud.
It won't wash. You're going to die, Dex. Pick a spot to lay down.
Not in the back, Lud. You'd give me a better chance than that.
Would I?
Look out, Lud.
Like I said, Dex, pick a spot. Well, that wraps it up, Kelly.
You better sit down, Lud.
No, this'll do. It won't be a long wait. I don't mind standing.
Suit yourself. 6 o'clock, Lud. Here's your envelope.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah.
Hello, Pete.
Hi, Father.
Just going to stop by. I heard the gunshots and knew you'd be around.
Well, let me tell you again, Father. I'm sorry about Jake. I don't know what else to say. I'm just sorry.
I believe you. We'll have the funeral for little Jake tomorrow. Maybe you want to stop by.
Yeah. Some things never figure. A 9-year-old kid shot down. No reason for it. None in the world. 9-year-old kid.
It's done, Pete. Don't waste your pity on little Jake. He's got a big lead on both of us.
I don't get you, Father.
You and I should die as good as a 9-year-old.
Jack Webb, with story by Jim Moser and music by Dick Cathcart. Scoring by Matty Matlock.
The music of Pete Kelly's Big Seven consists of Dick Cathcart on cornet, Matty Matlock on clarinet, Nick Fatul on drums, Ray Sherman on piano, George Vanness on guitar, Judd Donat on bass, Mo Schneider on trombone. The songs of Maggie Jackson were written by Arthur Hamilton. Pete Kelly's Blues is a presentation of the United States Armed Forces Radio Service.
Step by step on the side of the law through an actual case transcribed from official police files.
beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
Lieutenant, February 18th, the drone in Los Angeles. We're working a day watch out of robbery detail. My partner's Frank Smith, the boss, Bad Brown, chief detective. My name's Friday. It was 10:48 p.m. when I got back to the car. We had one team. Sure went out in it.
Was he in?
No, he's the guy who gave us a big story like carrying a lunch bucket. Always home by 9 o'clock.
Yeah. There was a car while you were out. Someone locked in a car trunk. We better roll on it.
Yeah.
What do you figure about your informant?
Well, I don't know. It's rain holed up someplace. Not on the street.
He's your boy, Joe. You ever come up with anything worthwhile?
Well, he used to. Got to be an awful lunch now. I can't stay sober long enough. Always talking about joining AA, but he never seems to get around to it.
Too bad. You're good if you give him a chance. If you want to be helped, they're the ones who can do it.
Well, I'll try to catch him in the morning. Huh? It's getting late. I'm tired.
Yeah, I could use some sleep. Hey, when we see this guy, you think he'll be able to give us anything?
I don't know. Yes, he might be able to come up with something.
Doesn't figure, Joe. Nice job they pulled. There's not a rumble in town on us. Not even a close identification.
Well, we don't turn them soon. It's going to be out of our hands. It's something for homicide to work on.
You think of this trunk for you might be the same one?
Well, if it's them, it makes number 10 for him. The old man will steam his head off in the morning. Still won't help his officer. He'll be sipping milk all day.
He just graduated the soft-boiled eggs. This thing will put him right back on the sippy diet.
Poor old idiot.
These and ulcers. He just can't win.
Yeah, that must be it up there, Frank. Guy waving the radio car.
Oh, yeah. There's 184 just coming in, too.
Yeah. Let's sit here. You want to get out my side?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Right around the corner, officer. I don't want to call. It didn't take long to get here.
I'll show you. Right around here?
Yes.
All right, Joe. Frank.
Yeah.
You police officers, too?
Yes, sir. My name's Friday. It's my partner, Frank Smith.
Joe, I'm Carl Miller. I own the drugstore on the corner. I'm the one who found the car, you know.
Yes, sir. If you show us the car.
Yeah, sure thing. Around this way. I'm way back from Miss Dalton's. Over some college bills for babies. That's his car. I thought I heard something.
Yes, sir.
I walked by, then I got to thinking, and maybe something might be wrong. So I went back. I looked in the car, but I couldn't see anything.
Yeah?
Well, I figured that maybe it might be my imagination. You know, maybe something else. And I heard this voice. Sounded like it was coming from the front. Tried to get it open, but it was locked. And that's when I called you.
Is this it?
Yes, sir. I put your ear against the front. It's about the hearing.
Yeah, let me see. There's somebody in there. I think we can get this thing open, huh?
I need
something to pry it open.
Yeah.
Got anything in your car, Al?
Oh, wait a minute. Maybe there's something in here. I'll look.
No, sir. Please don't touch the car.
What?
Don't touch the car, sir.
Hey, Stuart, you want to look for fingerprints? Should have thought of it myself. I'll check my door. Sure, it should have something in there.
All right, fine. Al?
Yeah.
Want to see if you got anything in your trunk?
Yeah, I'll check.
Fine.
All right, sir. We're police officers. We'll get you out.
Same one, sir, Joe?
Yeah, looks like I'm same MO. Hall was treating him. Frank and I went into the room.
I gave him a set to just quiet him down. He'll be okay in a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
What happened to him?
Oh, the trunk bandits again.
Vicious bunch.
You gonna release him, Doc?
Yeah, I'll be all right in 15 or 20 minutes. You know his name? I want to make out his treatment card.
No, he passed out. I'll let Foley get it.
He's coming around now.
Oh, you're all right now, Foley. Just relax. Take it easy.
See if you can sit up here on the edge of the table. Joe?
Yeah, Doc.
You want to pour a glass of water? Cups over there on the wall.
Yes, sir. I'll get you some water, sir.
That's it.
Now, just sit quiet.
Easy.
There you are, sir.
Oh, thanks.
Wait. Is that what we talked to him about?
Sure, go ahead.
Well, do you tell us what happened, sir?
Yeah. About 7:45. Maybe that's my wife. Said we were out of coffee. We were having a late dinner, so while she finished fixing it, I went out to get some.
Yeah.
I got down to Pico and Union. Signal was working. Stop. I pulled up. There were two guys standing on the safety zone. You know, like they were waiting for a streetcar.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the time was a lousy thing having to stand out in the rain waiting for a streetcar.
Yes, go ahead.
Well, the next thing I knew, one of them opened the door out in front. When they opened the door, I figured that maybe it was somebody that knew me. It was dark, you know. Couldn't see too well. The other one opened the back door and got right in the car. I knew darn soon I didn't know these guys. Well, the fellow in front had a gun pointed right at me. Looked like a cannon. Biggest gun I ever saw. Tell you, I was scared.
Yes.
Told me to pull up the curb. I did.
What happened then?
Told me to get in the back seat. I told them they could take my money, car, whatever they wanted. Just let me go. And the guy in the back told me to shut up and get back there with him. I asked him again to let go. Told him I wouldn't say anything. Said if they just let me go, I wouldn't tell anyone. I was scared, you know.
Yes, sir, we understand.
The guy in the front got a real wild look in his eye. Looked like he was crazy. I tried to get out of the car and he hit me. Side of the head with that gun. Then they grabbed me, threw me in the back seat, hauled me right over the front. Just dumped me on the floor in the back.
What did you do that?
Oh, nothing. I just laid there. Figured that maybe they'd think I was out cold and leave me alone.
Then what happened?
Well, the guy in the back took a roll of adhesive tape out of his pocket. Wrapped around my wrist and ankles.
Well, what did they do then, sir?
Well, they still thought I was knocked out. The guy in the front said, get me out of the car. Big fellow opened the door, lifted me out, picked me up like a sack of potatoes. The guy with a gun ran around, opened the trunk, and they threw me in. One of my legs was over the bumper, and the big guy grabbed it and twisted it so it had fit in the trunk. Almost died, but I didn't dare let him know it wasn't out.
Mm-hmm. And after that?
But he locked the car and drove away. Must have drove for a while and they stopped.
Mm-hmm. You got any idea how long they drove, sir? How far?
I couldn't see anything. Couldn't hear much. Just a little mumbling. I know they stopped at the gas station, no?
How's that?
Well, right after we stopped, I heard one of them yell at somebody. I couldn't tell what he was yelling. Then a little while, I heard somebody come back, take the gas cap off of the tank. And I heard the gas go in the tank right in front of the trunk. After the guy put the cap back on the tank, I heard one of the guys say something about stick-up.
Why were you stopped? Did you try to let the gas station attendant know if you were in the trunk?
Oh, sure. And I tried to kick the trunk, but the way they twisted my leg put me in, I couldn't move. They gagged me, too. Put a big piece of adhesive tape over my mouth. So I tried to let the guy know. I just couldn't do it.
You said if you heard one of them say, this is a stick-up.
Yeah. Those were the words you used to. This is a stick-up. Well, there was some quiet talking after that. I couldn't tell what was going on, and they drove away again.
You have no idea where this gas station was.
Oh, I'm sorry, but I was being bounced around that trunk. My head was where they hit me. I know they turned some corners, but I couldn't even guess where the station might be.
What happened then?
Same thing. They'd drive for a while, and they'd stop. They'd get out of the car, then come back. We'd start to drive again. Well, finally, they parked. I waited for them to come back. They didn't. I tried to get the gag off my mouth so I could yell for help. Rubbed my face against the spare tire and got loose. Then I yelled, kicked my feet against the trunk. I just about given up when you found me. Not sure I was through. It was getting hard to breathe in there.
Uh-huh. I can imagine.
No, you can't. Until you've been locked in the trunk. Nobody can imagine that.
Terrible.
Just terrible. Say, have you called me? That's my wife. Have you called her?
No, Sue, we haven't.
Of course, you'd be hopping mad. What time is it?
It's 11:45.
Almost 4 hours to get a pound of coffee. She'll be raising the roof. Would you call her? Tell her where I am?
Yes, sir, I'll call her.
Want to give me the number? Madison 3-4656.
Uh-huh.
Tell her you're calling for Henry. Explain what happened.
All right, sir, right away.
Officer.
Yeah?
Be sure to tell her you're a policeman. She'll believe you.
Yes, sir. I have a couple of questions, sir. I have to start this card.
Sure.
I hate to ask. Could I have another cup of water? I'll get it.
What do you want to know?
I know your full name.
Henry J. Hilder.
H-I-L-L-D-A-L-E?
Uh-huh.
All right, sir. Here's your water.
Thank you. I don't know why I'm so thirsty. Got in the trunk, I guess. Got my throat.
Yes. What's your address, Mr. Hilder?
920 North Lebanon Avenue. Phone number is Madison 34656.
4656. How old?
48 to 49 this October.
Mr. Hilder, you have a way to get home. We'll run him home, Doc.
Oh, what about my car? Can't I take it?
Well, we're going to have to process the fingerprints so we can release it to you in the morning.
You called me?
Yes, sir. I just talked to her.
Where's she store?
Well, she was a little upset. Worry about you.
But you told her about what happened.
Yes, sir. Everything's all right now.
That's good.
Mr. Hilder.
Yes, Doc?
You can leave now. I suggest you see your own doctor in the morning. Just check up.
Oh, all right. Well, thanks a lot for your trouble. Sure appreciate it.
That's okay. No, it's just this way. You already down here?
Oh, yeah.
I'll get the battle. Same story, huh, Joe? Yeah. One big trouble. What's that? We're hearing it too often. 12:18 p.m. We left Jersey City Receiving Hospital and drove Mr. Hildale back to his home. On the way, we asked him for a description, but he was only able to give us a very meager one. We did get enough information from him for our crime report. He told us he'd come in the next day to look through the mug books. We checked into the city hall, got a DI number, and filled out the crime report. We booked the adhesive tape as evidence. The information on the robberies the suspect had pulled that night had come into the office. There had been three of them, and among them was a service station that Mr. Hildale had told us about. At 1:46 a.m., Frank and I signed out of the office and went home to get some sleep. 7:58 a.m., we talked with Captain Didion.
Here's the description we got from the service station, Lieutenant. Want to look at it?
Yeah, okay. Same guy.
Frank?
Yes, Skipper.
Want to hand me that milk?
Yeah. Here you are.
Stomach straight and kinks. Kidnapping, the 23rd robbery. When are you two going to get off the dime and bring those guys in?
Oh, do everything we can, Skipper, you know that.
And it's not enough. I know you guys have been beating your heads against the wall on this thing, but the corner pocket's on my back, and we got to break it.
We've contacted all our informants. We've run on every lead that's turned up. They all go to the same place. No way.
I'm giving the chief every excuse I can. I'm not going to try to sell him any more. I don't think he'd buy him. Now, look. The guys who are pulling these jobs are flesh and blood. They eat and sleep. Somebody in town knows them. They're not trying them. We're climbing. These guys aren't the brainiest ones in the world. If they were, they wouldn't be getting the cars the way they do.
Well, yeah, that's figured.
How about the car? Find anything?
I called Leighton Prince. They said the car was dry enough to work on. I couldn't tell if anyone had said they called back.
Mm-hmm. I've been going over that crime report. Maybe got an idea.
Yeah.
The way it looks, they picked up the cars in one area, pulled the job from the same area. Could be that they live in that area.
Makes sense.
They've been working inside a 30-square block, straight down the hill, 7th to Pico. You got a description on them. Talked to the desk clerks at every hotel and boarding house in the area. Robbery, Didion?
Yeah, he's here.
See you, Jim.
Thanks. This side. What do you have,
hmm?
You bet. That's the way it goes sometimes.
Yeah. Well, thanks a lot.
Bergman?
Yeah, just finished the car. It's clean. Not a thing on it.
For distribution in the area that we were going to canvas. 12:15 p.m.
sorry, Sergeant. Didn't recognize any of them.
Well, that's all right, sir. I understand.
Don't think this picture was there. I'd feel awful if I saw it and didn't recognize it, but I'm pretty sure you just don't have a picture of the man.
Yes, sir. Well, maybe we'd like to rest a little bit before you look at any more.
Yeah, if I can. Get a little confused looking at so many. After a while, they all begin to look alike.
Yes, sir.
Police doctors.
Oh, police.
That's right. what you want.
We'd like to know if you've got anyone here who answers these descriptions.
Like this, huh?
Yes, sir.
Well, it's kind of hard to say. If you had a picture of them, it might help.
I'm sorry, sir. We don't have a picture, just that description.
Sure, it could be the fellow's 4'8" and sure fit what he says here. Yeah, I bet it's them. I knew we should have called you fellas about.
Sir?
See, the day before yesterday, anyway, she's a girl, you know, cleans up. She's taking care of the room. She said that she opened the closet. She saw a gun laying on the shelf. You know, right out in the open.
Did you report that to police?
Huh? What'd you say?
Did you report it to the police?
Oh, no. No, I didn't. You see, I figured that, you know, live and let live. Mama didn't cause me any trouble. I wasn't about to cause any. Me and me talked about whether we should let you know, but then we decided against it. I didn't see none, we should have.
Why did you tell us when you saw them last, sir?
Oh, well, a couple of hours ago.
They registered here?
Yeah, Andy Scott and Ed Willis. They're up in room 4A. Ain't there now, though. Let's see. Well, I'll be gone. He ain't there. Well, I guess you're upset. I must have given the key and didn't remember.
That's room 408, she said.
What'd you say?
I said that's room 408.
Oh, yeah, that's right. 4844. They're up there now.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, what are you wanted for? The dangerous criminals?
Well, we don't know, sir.
Well, be careful. You know, we wouldn't want anything to happen.
Yes, sir. Here, I'll get the button. All right. What do you say, you Joe?
I don't know. I hope there are boys. Don't tell them, right?
Johnny Madero, Pier 23. You know, it doesn't pay to buy a fast car in San Francisco because most of the time you got to be in low gear. The town is laid out like the profile of a chorus line, and the only time it flattens out is where it runs into the bay. The waterfront goes from south of the ferry building out past the China docks. And on a clear day, you can see them batting baseballs over on Alcatraz. Pier 23 is over toward the left field sign. And not far from there, you'll find Johnny Madero's boat shop. My place. Oh, I rent boats, and I do anything else that means long odds and short hours. It's a way to make a living. And if you never save enough to get married, at least you got enough to leave town. Maybe I should have left town Monday afternoon. I bought a paper and I read about a buildup on a heavyweight fight in L.A. I stopped in at Lofty's and the boys said neither one of those fighters could beat an egg with a power drill. About 3 o'clock, I started down Post Street when I spotted a new auction house. It was small, with enough dough-changing hands to buy back Manhattan Island. Inside, it was packed, and up on a wooden stand, a bald-headed guy was selling everything but his suspenders. So I sat down in back, and I noticed a girl standing up against the wall. She was wearing dark green sunglasses, but the rest of her was just about as secret as a plow on the bathroom floor. Her hair was the color of half-past midnight, and her dress was made of the kind of goods you buy from Spiders. After a while, she walked over to me. Right away, she started to get nervous. When you look like her, you got a right to be.
Mind if I sit down?
They're your legs, lady. If you want to rest them, rest them.
Thanks. You seem to like the view.
Just temporary. I'm leaving.
Will you get excited if I ask you to stay?
Are you going
to
be proud if I do?
Please. I want you to do me a favor. It won't take long. It'll be a small one.
How small?
They're going to auction off a black leather suitcase in a few minutes. It belongs to me. I must have it back.
Can you speak the language? Do your own bidding, huh?
I don't want someone to know I'm here. It's important. I'll pay you $50 to bid for me.
You just hired me.
Just start bidding and keep on bidding till you get that suitcase. I want it at any price.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here's a special item of interest. A black leather suitcase arrived yesterday. Contents unknown. It's handsome. It's beautiful. It's never been opened. Now, who's got sporting blood? The leather alone is worth at least $25. And it's heavy. It's heavy. It could be full of bricks and it could be full of gold. That's what makes it interesting. Now, who's going to start the bidding? Who's going to start it off with a big one?
$2.
Come on. That's an insult. $2? Who'll get 15?
$10.
10. Who'll get 30? 10. Who'll get 30?
Start pitching for our team, mister.
$25.
50. 50.
Double it.
$100.
$100. The man in the gallery bids $100. You heard him, folks. $100. Who'll get two?
$200.
$200.
You got competition, lady.
I got you. Keep doubling.
$400.
$400. That man in the gallery's got second vision. He knows what the suitcase is worth. The bid's $400. Who'll get $800? Four. Who'll get
$800.
$800. The man in front here says $800. Who'll give $1,000? The bid's $800. Who'll give $1,000?
Go ahead. Surprise the man.
The OPA won't like this.
You're working for me now. Make it $1,000.
$1,000.
$1,000. The man in back bids $1,000. Who'll get $1,500? $1,000. Who'll get $1,500? All right. $1,000 once. $1,000 twice. $1,000 for the third and last time. Oh, true bidding. Show it to the men of the gallery. Please go up and pay this price now.
Here's the money. Pick it up and come back. I'll be waiting.
Yeah.
And don't let him open it. Whatever you do, don't let him open it.
It's your party, lady. I won't even let him peek.
There's the lucky man coming down the aisle now. Give him room. Give him room. Here he is, and here's your suitcase, mister. Want to open it and tell the folks what's inside?
Yeah, what's in it, Mac?
Just one of my relatives. Here's a dope.
Yeah, sure. All right. Now we have another item here.
Oh.
Sorry, son. I was just going for the empty seat.
Yeah, we'll wait for your blockers next time, Pop. Where's the girl, the brunette with the dark glasses?
It's a jail term, son. I don't follow him home anymore.
Well, she was here a minute ago. You must have seen her leave.
No.
Think about it. She must have walked right past you. Think about it.
No, son. When you get to be my age, you don't even do that.
I felt kind of silly, the same way you do when you find a hole in your sock at the shoe store. But it wasn't my dough that bought that case, so I couldn't beef much. When I got back to the office, I started working on the lock with the key. The case was made of plain black leather, and it was kicked around more than Minnie's gong. Then I opened it. A shiny-looking saxophone was laid out in three parts. For $1,000, you can buy a whole brass section. So I went through each piece looking for a reason. There was a paper box inside the case. It had a gross of reeds in it. Same kind you find on the mouthpiece of any saxophone. I couldn't do much more, so I wrapped up the case and put it up in my closet. Then the door opened, and the trouble had a face. This was the way it looked in the morning. He stood there in the middle of the room, and his eyes held me like a fly at the end of two needles. You noticed his eyebrows. They were bushy and thick, and if they got any worse, he'd have to hire a native guide.
Hello, are you Madero?
That's my story. You got a better one?
It's sadder than yours. I'm the guy you left behind at the auction. Who are you bidding for?
Who are you asking for?
Myself.
I suppose we get real friendly. What's your name?
Dunlap, Larry Dunlap. Now, introduce me to the girl who was coaching you.
All right. She was a souped-up brunette with a disappearing act. Now, what does that prove?
Unless you find her in a cemetery, never trust a woman. Especially Claire Underwood.
What do you want from me?
I'll take that black leather suitcase you won at the auction.
Look, I saved you some dough. I'll make a pig of yourself. Try to be nice.
I will. I won't kick you when you're dead. Where's that suitcase? You're making me nervous.
So if you got an itch, see a doctor. What makes you so big?
Vitamins. I know all about the sacks, Madero. It belongs to me. Give it to me or I start looking.
You better have a license. The sacks isn't that important.
It is to me. Maybe I want to start a hot shop.
I'll hold out for your girlfriend. She owes me $50 and I need the dough.
I'll double anything she gives you.
If you mean money, give me a hit.
What, $100 do?
Yeah. The sacks is in the closet on top. Here. Come on. Give me a hand. Give me a hand.
Oh, sure. You've got a hand, Madero. Now play it out.
Some days you're not going to make out any better than an ice cube at a cocktail party. When Dunlap hit me, I folded up and my head got the size of a social worker's heart. Well, I started tossing around on the rug. It took me longer to stop than it took Hayden to quit Jersey. I knew that Sachs was gone, so there was no point in getting up. I started dreaming about that day a Cleveland bellhop gave me a key to the wrong room. It was going all right, too, until somebody began shaking me. In that small room, I didn't have to look up to know who it was. Because Inspector Warcheck of San Francisco Homicide is the kind of guy you stand next to in a hurricane and wonder what happened to the ventilation.
Making a wish, Madero?
Yeah, it is, so it didn't come true. What are you collecting?
Alibis. What's yours for last night at 12 o'clock?
I was in bed.
You got a witness?
No, you can't let them all.
Yeah, that's the way a guy named Charlie Reiser felt.
So maybe it's an epidemic.
So maybe you started it. Someone shot him dead. The guy was a musician.
Try some of the neighbors.
I'll try you first.
You're reaching, Warcheck. I never even heard of the guy.
Oh, that's a handicap, Madero. Maybe you just heard of his instrument, huh?
All right, let me guess. It was a sack.
Hey, you're very bright. An auctioneer helped me trace it down to you. Now, what's the pitch?
A wild one, Warcheck. A dame forced me to do her a favor.
Uh-huh. I bet you force easy.
She paid me to bid for the sacks and then took a powder after I won it.
You got an active memory. Does it include a name?
Yeah. Claire Underwood. Run it down and see what it gets you.
Oh, now stop threatening me, Madero. I think that sax is tied in with the murder. Now, where is it?
You're a little late. A torpedo named Larry Dunlap just walked in and sapped me for it.
Yeah? How hard did he sap you, Madero?
Hmm?
There's a pool of blood behind your desk, and it doesn't look like yours. How'd it get there?
I don't know, Warcheck. Maybe somebody got lost and figured it was a blood bank. How do I know?
Yeah. Maybe they thought it was a morgue, too. Left the body. Now, look around.
Yeah, do that. Look under the rug, too. Maybe the guy was thin.
All right, Madero. So far, you're in the clear. But if there's blood, there must be a body close by. It'll show. When it does, we'll turn it in for yours.
I'll remember.
Like you remember that $1,000?
Huh?
The auction house, Madero. The $1,000 you gave the joint got homesick and left.
I'm broke, Warcheck.
Yeah?
You'll have to stand on your head to pin this on me.
Maybe I will.
Maybe you're right. I forgot about your head. Once Warcheck sticks to you, you might as well try to pull a mustard plaster off a throw rug. He stood there for a minute, blinking at the light, and you could see big pebbles of sweat standing out on his forehead. He took a handkerchief out of his pocket, and when it came down, it was wet enough to wash all the windows in Lower Manhattan. After a while, he walked out. I watched him out of the window. I tried to figure how I got into this. It was like trying to trace back a conversation to see what words started it. There were lots of questions, and not too much time. Why was a saxophone and a grocer Reed's worth all that dough? And who left his blood on my rug as a deposit? The girl must have known what was in the case, but why did she leave it with me? Oh, I couldn't make it add up, so I looked up the only good guy I know. A waterfront priest named Father Leahy. He knows most of the bad boys around the piers, and he's heard enough sins to start an art colony. Around Lofty's, they got his name above the line, and that's a tough trick, because along the waterfront, an archangel couldn't get a cup of coffee without hucking a wing. I found him over at the parish house having dinner.
Hello, Johnny. You want some wine?
No, thanks, Father.
That's one of the good things about this job. You get wine with your meals.
Yeah, I know.
Except you've got to watch out. I knew a guy in the seminary liked to eat between meals.
Yeah, yeah.
But the bishop fixed him. He sent him to a rich parish, and the guy had to throw away half his sermons.
I'm in trouble, Father.
Did you buy elevator shoes, or is that a bump on your head?
Somebody knocked me down when I wasn't looking.
Did you get the license number?
It just felt like a truck. I got hit with a club. That's why I want you to help me, Father.
Johnny, you misinterpret my mission in life. You need a policeman. I'm only a priest. Besides, I'm eating.
Look, Father, Homicide wants to tack a murder on me.
There goes my appetite. Who's dead? Anybody I could have helped?
His name was Charlie Reiser. He was a musician.
If he's going in the right direction, he may get some work. How did you meet him?
I didn't. I never heard of the guy. It was all a surprise to me.
Sounds more like a shock.
I got a bum shake from the start, Father. A gal with a big purse promised to pay me something if I'd bid for a black suitcase at an auction.
What was the matter with her? Laryngitis?
She was trying to keep somebody from noticing her. but she must have weakened in the final stretch.
What do you mean?
I won the bid with $1,000, but when I came back, the gal was gone.
And you were left holding the bag. What was in it?
A saxophone and a gross of reeds. You could buy the whole outfit with a $5 down payment.
What makes it worth $1,000?
I don't know, Father. The sax belonged to Charlie Reiser. A guy named Dunlap offered me $200 for it.
All that money for a saxophone, and they wouldn't allow me $40 on that old organ.
Dunlap slugged me when my back was turned and piled up a lead.
Did the sax go for free?
Somebody paid for it. When I woke up, there was a lot of blood on the floor.
Yours?
It was unclaimed, but I have an idea a body's going to turn up without it.
You have nothing but murder on your mind, Johnny. Why don't you settle down with a good book?
If Warcheck tags me, I'll have to borrow yours, Father. Right now, I need you to check on a few people for me.
Sure, but I'll need a couple of names for them first.
You know a lot of the combo boys, Father. Check up on Charlie Reiser's friends, especially his women. And find out where Larry Dunlap fits in. Will you do it, Father?
Yes, Johnny, I'll do it. But if I find out you're calling him wrong, I'll drop over to Warcheck's side.
Thanks, Father. If you help me out of this, you're a good guy. You're an angel.
But stop pushing me. I'm not that anxious yet.
When I left Father Leahy, I ran over my leads. You could have counted them on one finger and you'd still have to cheat. The only guy worth looking up was the auctioneer on Eddy Street. Maybe that was all revenge. Why did he tell Warcheck that I took that $1,000 back? Well, I figured I'd find out, so I grabbed a cab back to his store. When I got there, the joint was locked up, but a big neon sign blinked the name J.C. Cole. There was another light coming from the back, so I followed it down. Inside, Cole was working over his cash register tape. I didn't knock, and right away he started making funny noises in his throat. I noticed he was wearing a vest without a tie, and his sleeves were rolled up with big rubber bands. His elbows stuck out, and they were red and knotted up like a baby's face with cramps. And then he made his opening bid.
It's a little late. What can I sell you, mister?
A straight story.
Huh?
The one you told headquarters had too many frills.
Hey, wait a minute. You're the same fellow who bought that suitcase.
You got a good head, Flynn. How good is it on robbery?
It was dark. I thought it was you, so I called the cops.
You started fast, but you're fading in the stretch.
$1,000 was gone. I figured you took your money back.
That's an early mistake. It wasn't my dough.
You sound like you're mad. Is that a gun in your pocket, huh?
If it makes you talk about that suitcase, I'll say yes.
I don't know what you mean. I said you were taking your chances. A ton of bricks, a ton of gold. Remember, I got to make a living, you know.
You don't have to crowd them in. What gives a sax a $1,000 price tag?
I don't know, I tell you. I don't know a thing.
Yeah, well, we'll go into politics later. I think I'm lying.
It was just another suitcase, an old leather suitcase with a sax inside. I just tell you, I don't know a thing.
Yeah, keep it up, fella. You'll tell me everything that way. Now, how did you know there was a sax in that case if you never opened it?
Well, Now, listen, mister, let's be friends. I got a little money. Let's be friends.
Go on.
I was just trying to get a little ahead. I got a wife and a kid, a big kid, so I switched saxophones. I took out the original sax with the reeds and put in an older one.
What'd you do with the original?
It was a pretty nice one, brand new, so I sold it to someone, reeds and all, for $200.
You're slowing down. Who's someone, a relative?
He's a friend named Bud, Bud Overbeck. He plays tenor sax at the Downbeat Club. That original was something special, huh?
Yeah, you should have held out for $1,000 on both ends.
Now, listen, fella, Bud's a friend, a good friend on my wife's side. You won't hurt him, will you?
I'll send you a fight if he believes.
Yeah, sure. I'll say that. Anything else, huh?
Yeah. Stop stuttering. You'll give that kid of yours a complex. When he opened the door, you could tell he wanted to shake me worse than a summer cold. I didn't like him any better, but he'd given me something solid to work on. So I got over to the Club Downbeat. It's a jazz cellar that warms over King Oliver at 6 bits a throw. Five-piece combo was writing a chorus slow and easy, and you knew the only notes they ever read were on IOUs. There were a dozen or so jazz fans huddled around the bandstand, and if you looked real close at their faces, you saw something that looked like pain. I asked the bartender who Overbeck was, and he pointed out the blonde kid with a face made of warm putty playing a black saxophone. I walked backstage to a small dressing room where the boys grabbed their second wind with a short one. When I opened the door, Claire Underwood stood there holding her breath.
Hello, Johnny. You look angry. Put away those daggers,
I will, baby. I'll guess that you killed Reiser for a saxophone.
Guess again. Why should I kill anyone for a sax?
Tell me why it's worth a grand, and I'll answer that one, too.
All right, Johnny. I'm sentimental. Say Charlie Reiser was my boyfriend, and I wanted to keep his sax as a memory.
Must have been quite a memory, baby.
You didn't meet Charlie.
But I did meet Larry Dunlap. He wanted the sax, too. Why?
How would I know, Johnny? Maybe he was taking lessons.
They weren't that kind. He has too good a lip.
So have I. Only I use it differently.
All right, stop puckering, sweetheart. I want some sense now.
Please, Johnny. If you leave now, I'll give you double what I owe you from the auction.
That's not enough. Look, baby, count up your bills and tell me what a murder rap is worth, huh?
We'll haggle over it later, Johnny. Just meet me at the Ajax Hotel, and I promise you, you'll get a better figure.
Yeah. You gonna add some interest?
Come here, and I'll show you what I mean.
I'm not running a service. I need some answers. Come on, come on. I want some action. Come on.
Use your arms, Johnny.
You got too big a mouth, baby. Somebody's gonna close it on you.
Show me, Johnny.
All right.
The music stopped, Johnny.
What do you care? We're not dancing.
Johnny, please, you're squeezing me too tight.
Yeah, it's a bad habit. Now tell me about that sax.
Listen to me, Johnny. I told you I gotta see Overbeck first. I'll tell you everything later.
Yeah, after you talk Overbeck out of his sax, huh?
Yes. Is it a deal?
You're too anxious to sign. I'll talk to Overbeck myself.
All right, Johnny. I'll help you get him here quicker.
Yeah, what are you gonna do?
Scream, Johnny. Scream. Listen.
Louder, baby. You'll really need it in a minute.
Help! Help! Help!
Hey, what's the matter? What was she screaming about, mister?
She couldn't catch me.
This man's drunk. He was trying to snatch my purse.
Is that true, mister?
Call a cop and find out.
Yeah, I will.
No, no. Please, don't bother. Just get him out. Just throw him out, Mr. Overbeck.
You heard the lady, mister. Do I get rough?
Save your strength, Overbeck. You'll need it later. Claire had a nice act, if you didn't mind playing straight man to a vulture. She draped herself on Overbeck's arm, and she looked as cool as a vacation in Maine. As I walked out, Overbeck was still showing his teeth, but it didn't matter, because you got the idea he wasn't strong enough to fight off a sneeze. Well, there wasn't much I could do except wait for Claire to show. But it started to drizzle, so I figured my best bet was her hotel. In the lobby, a rose-colored carpet with a touch of yellow jaundice led to the desk. The clerk told me she hadn't come in yet, but for $5 he could tell I was a friend. He gave me her key. I went upstairs, and when I opened Claire's door, I knew something was wrong. A lot of towels were thrown all over the floor, and everything was gone from the closet but the mothballs. Claire had skipped, and before I could walk out, Dunlap walked in. One hand was in his pocket, and the other had enough tape to wrap up a mummy.
Can I come in, Madero?
You're old enough, Dunlap. Make up your own mind.
I have. Where's Claire?
You're early. I think she's still busy.
Give me a magazine, I'll wait.
It'll be a long one. I'm not hanging around.
Oh, the fun's just beginning. Sit down. Sit down.
I guess I am tired.
Yeah, this gun makes everybody drowsy. Now, what's your time with Claire?
Nothing that's deep-rooted. Are you writing a column?
Yeah, the obituary, and you're going to make the morning deadline.
You're too cocky, Dunlap. Don't turn your back.
I won't. Claire blew her chance. The best she could do was this arm.
Yeah, you ruined my carpet.
When they pass your cup around, I'll be jealous. In the meantime, you're going to stick around until Claire brings that black saxophone.
I hope she's got some food in the icebox.
What do you mean?
Well, if you're waiting for that sax, we're going to starve to death. Claire's not going to show.
What makes you a prophet?
A guy named Bud Overbeck. He had the sax last, and Claire was working him over for it.
I'll work you over for less. What are the rest of her plans?
She was warm. Maybe she left a smoke signal.
All right. You're getting too stubborn.
Put away the gun, Dunlap. You can only use one arm.
I'll clean the bases with this index finger. Pick a spot to fall.
Hey, don't clutter up the floor now, Dunlap. We got company.
Hey, what's this? The wrong room? Claire said we'd be alone.
We are. Just the three of us.
Who's you, Madero?
Huh? What are you talking about? Claire told me to come here. She told me to wait for her.
Look, fella, save your lip for another cause. Just tell me where she left you.
I don't feel so good. She was at the Downbeat Club. She was helping me put my sacks away. I just came up here to wait. We were going to be alone.
All right, fella. I'm cutting down the crowd. You're with Madero now. I'm leaving.
Yeah, I'm going home, too. I feel sick. I'm going home.
You'll never make it on your knees. What's the matter?
I don't know. I guess I gave the new horn too big a ride tonight. I got a weak heart.
Your eyes aren't too strong either. You're walking right into that closet.
They told me not to play so hard. Maybe I played too hard. Help me, fella. You look familiar. I seen you somewhere, huh? You look fuzzy.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel sick. Someone must have slipped me something. I never felt like this before. I'm sick. Real sick.
You'll never get any sicker, fella. Overbeck was dead even before he had a chance to see if Gabriel paid his boy's scale. He hit the floor and turned over on his back, and you figured he'd cross the River Jordan with a backstroke. I got a good look at him now. His face was all twisted up like bedsheets after a nightmare, and up near his hairline, a long, thin scar ran into his scalp. Well, I didn't know what killed Overbeck, but whatever it was, he didn't get 2 weeks' notice. I figured if homicide caught me here, I'd get my walking papers, too, right down to the last 20 feet. I started for the door, but Warchick opened it for me. He looked at the body and then over to me.
You on a spree, Madero?
If you're footing the bill, Warchick.
The state will from now on. Now tell me about the guy on the floor.
He's dead.
Must have had parents. What's his name?
Bud Overbeck. He was a musician at the Downbeat Club.
Yeah. Tell me some more.
Roll him, Warchick. Maybe he's got a diary.
Wallet. All right, Madero. How long you been here?
Why?
The wallet's empty.
Well, that's too bad. Your girlfriend's going to have to get along with last week's presents.
I trail a guy named Dunlap up to this apartment, and I find you and a dead body. Now, there's a tie, any way you look at it. Mm-hmm. Just what happened?
I don't know, Warchick. I didn't see the picture. I just tagged by for the end. You know?
Must have been a sad one. I think he's poisoned. Don't like the look in his eyes.
Get the girl who put it there.
Well, just give me a hint. Huh?
Overbeck was playing caveman with Claire Underwood before he came up here.
What does that give him besides hair?
Maybe a Mickey. When I left, she was warming up an argument for his saxophone.
She get it?
She didn't. Dunlap's losing man hours. He just walked out here, and I think she's in his list.
Yeah. I'm beginning to get an idea now myself.
Does it hurt?
You and the Underwood girl are running some kind of a racket with that saxophone. She left you behind her front for her.
You haven't seen her, Warchick. She doesn't need that kind of help.
But you will when I get through checking. Still got a few calls to make. I want the lab to work over the body. By then, I'll have enough to come back and hold you, Madero.
You couldn't hold a lap dog with a suction pump.
All right, big shot. I'll go a long way to get you for this. A long way.
You got the drag, will
you? Yeah. It's going to slow you down a little.
Warchick wanted to mother the body until the coroner came, and when I left, he was squeezing himself into a chair. He fit tighter than a whale in a crib. Well, you could word it any way you like, but the big riddle was that saxophone. Claire had it, and Dunlap wanted it, and a couple of guys died for it. My only alibi was Dunlap, but you might as well ask Kahn to hold still for Lewis. I buzzed back to the office, but there was no message from Father Leahy. So I stared out the window for a while, wondering how to bake a cake with a dynamite charge when the phone rang. Yeah?
Hello, Johnny. This is Father Leahy.
What'd you find out, Father?
It's not pleasant, Johnny. I'm down at the morgue. A lab report on Bud Overbeck just came in.
He died of poisoning, huh, Father?
The bitter kind. Overbeck's heart couldn't stand all that dope.
Hmm?
Coroner found a used saxophone reed in Overbeck's pocket. It was soaked in hop.
So that's what made that saxophone so big. The grosser reeds.
That's right, Johnny. Overbeck was absorbing the stuff while he played.
Oh.
He probably never knew what hit him.
Well, what about Reiser? How does he figure?
Reiser was making his pin money peddling dope to nightclubs. He was getting his shipments from Mexico.
How did Claire and Dunlap figure?
They were a couple of partners who wanted to ease out Reiser and go into business for themselves.
The idea must have gone to Claire's head. She's doing a solo now, and Dunlap thinks she has the sax.
Warchick feels the same way about you, Johnny. He's out to tag you for everything.
He's smarter than that.
I don't know him that well. But it adds up in his book because he thinks you're leaving town.
Hmm?
Someone's booked a passage on the 2 a.m. plane from Mexico this morning in the name of Jay Madero.
I'm being jockeyed, Father. It's either Claire or Dunlap. They're both as black as sin.
Maybe so, but Warchick still thinks you're the dark horse.
Up until now, it was like trying to sell a toupee to a ball-headed eagle. But when the turn comes, everything happens in a hurry, and you began breaking more records than a disc jockey with a hangover. If Father Leahy was right, Claire or Dunlap had enough dreams in that saxophone to start a waltz contest, and I knew if they both got out of town, Warchick would be around to tag me for the last dance. So I got out to Mills Field, and out on the far end of the strip, a twin-engine plane was warming up. Claire was standing with her back toward me, and even from here, you could see what a stiff tailwind could do to a landing gear. When she saw me, she raised her eyebrows and figured her temperature was even higher.
Sorry I had to borrow your name, Johnny.
You're too small for it, baby.
I got a big ego.
And that gun bolsters it, huh?
That's my story.
Well, tell it to Homicide. They'll take a nibble on either you or Dunlap.
Better throw him Dunlap. I got a date in Mexico City.
It's a blind one, baby. You're going in the wrong direction.
Larry, what are you doing here? I thought you...
I want those reeds, baby.
You'll be peddling pencils when I'm through with you.
I'll leave the sides too, baby. I'll be lonely.
You won't need that kind of music where you're going, Larry.
You're the ones that talk, baby. I trusted you. We were going to do this together. I trusted you.
We all make mistakes. You got the short end.
I'll stretch it a little. You got another chance. Let's team up again.
Sorry, Larry. I'm crowding you out.
You only think so.
Now get out of my way. I got to make the plane.
Make a grave first. I want that stuff.
I won't miss again. Stay away, Larry.
Put up a sign.
Yeah.
You missed again. Give me the gun.
No, I'm selfish. I'll hold on. Pull him off me, Madero. Pull him off.
There's a lot.
All right, baby. You run out of chances. It's my turn now.
No. Please, Larry. Put the gun away. You win. I'll split it with you now. You win. Honest, Larry, you win.
Just to show you I agree.
You're through, guy. Drop the gun.
Yeah. What are the odds of my getting away in that plane?
70-30, maybe.
Things are too tough at 50-50. Come on, I'll ride downtown with you.
Well, Dunlap told the whole story down at headquarters. It seems that Reiser, Claire, and he were buying dope from Mexico and peddling it here in the form of soaked-up reeds. Reiser was contact man in Mexico, but the only way they knew him down there was by his black saxophone. Claire and Dunlap decided to narrow the profits down to two by shooting Reiser and taking over. Claire used the gun, and, well, that started her to thinking that she could do even better with a single act. She needed that black sax, though. Reiser got wind of it and hid the sax with the reeds in the basement. His landlady found it after he was tumbled and sold it to that auction house. And Claire had me buy it and followed me back to the office where she tried to peg down Dunlap. The sack she took turned out to be a phony because the auctioneer had already sold the black one to Bud Overbeck. The track was switched to him, but not soon enough. Overbeck didn't know the reeds were loaded, and after an all-night jam session, he folded up with a heart attack. Well, Warchek asked only one question. Wasn't it tough luck for an innocent guy like Overbeck? I don't know. At least there was one time he played right out of this world.
Johnny Madero, Pier 23, starring Jack Webb as Johnny Madero, has been presented by the Mutual Network. Johnny Madero is written by Herb Margolis and Lou Morheim. Gail Gordon played Father Leahy, and Bill Conrad played Inspector Warchek of Homicide. Others in the cast were Helene Burke, Bob Holton, Herb Butterfield, Irvin Lee, and Herb Rollinson. Original music was composed and conducted by Harry Zimmerman, and the entire production was directed by Nat Wolf. We invite you to listen again next week over most of these stations when Mutual presents another adventure in the life of Johnny Madero, Pier 23. Tony Lofrano speaking.
This program came to you from Hollywood. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.